All right, so I'm Nathan Hendren. It's a pleasure to be here with all of you. I'm going to give a couple of lectures this afternoon. First is going to be entitled The Social Cost of Inequality. We're going to talk a lot about just ways of thinking about policies that try to deal with inequality and how we want to think about the welfare impact of those policies. And then in the second lecture later this afternoon, we'll talk, kind of do a little bit more of a deep dive thinking about intergenerational mobility and kind of intergenerational inequality, and think a little bit about the causes of intergenerational inequality and a little bit about policies that one can do to think about mitigating. All right, so with that, I guess I'll start here on the social cost of inequality. And the basic idea here that we're going to talk about is that the existence of inequality, the fact that people are different, generates this kind of need when we to make interpersonal comparisons. If you want to have some kind of a preference for one policy relative to another policy, as long as those policies affect people, different people differently, we have to figure out how are we going to resolve those interpersonal comparisons. And so this is something that you face with a range of economic policies. You can think of Brexit, you can think of immigration policy, you can think of all kinds of trade policies. You can think about human capital policies, investment in children, mergers of large companies that might have price effects that has distributional consequences. In all these settings, we have to resolve interpersonal comparisons. Moreover, if you wanted to have some kind of general notion of social well-being, for those of you that have that are familiar with kind of motivating, you know, how we end up with constructing numbers like GDP today, there's an old literature that argues from a kind of ground-up framework that these can be interpreted as normative statistics, where under some conditions you might actually be willing to compare two GDP numbers and say this society is better off than this other society. Now that's resolving interpersonal comparisons in a very particular way that we'll talk about that we may not like, but this goal of having a general notion of a societal well-being requires implicitly making interpersonal comparisons. All right, so how can we do this? How can we resolve these interpersonal comparisons? Broadly in the literature, there's two methods that people have gone about trying to try to address this problem. The first is this Calder-Hicks compensation principle. So this was proposed in a couple of very classic papers by Calder and Hicks. And what they suggested is, well, geez, if you've got a policy where there's winners and there's losers from this policy, let's ask whether the winners could compensate the losers through individual specific transfers. So to be concrete, if the winners win by, you know, they're $10 better off, they're willing to pay $10 for some policy, and the losers are going to lose $5. Well, geez, let's just imagine that the winners paid $5 to the losers, and now everybody is better off. And so through this hypothetical comparison, we say, well, look, if there exists this potential Pareto improvement through these motivating through these transfers, then let's just prefer that alternative environment. And so this logic of these potential, these hypothetical transfers motivated this focus on what has come to be known as aggregate surplus or efficiency. If you've ever heard of the efficiency equity trade-off, this is the papers where that actually comes from, where the notion of efficiency is just the aggregate willingness to pay for a policy, unweighted, or just thinking about summing up that willingness to pay. And so this has been criticized over the years for a range of different issues, but most crucially is that it doesn't really account for distributional equity. In the Calder-Hicks world, we're not imagining that people actually implement these transfers, so some people really are made better off and some people really are made worse off. And if you are, if you happen to have a stronger preference for the well-being of the people who are made worse off, you may not like this Calder-Hicks methodology to resolve interpersonal comparisons. And so this motivated a second approach that uses a social welfare function to value a policy. So what does a social welfare function do? It says, well, I'm going to imagine putting different weights on different people when I aggregate up surplus. So if all of you have different willingness to pay for some kind of a policy that's either positive or negative, I'm going to give you each your Pareto weight, and then we're going to sum it up, and imagine whether that sum of weighted willinesses to pay is going to be positive. And if it is, then we will pursue that or decide that that policy is desirable. And so this works great. You can sort of accompany or account for any kind of distributional preference just by giving anybody in the room a different weight on their willingness to pay. So what's the problem? Well, we need the weights. We need to figure out, you know, where do these come from? They don't come from anywhere. Theory doesn't give us any of those kind of weights necessarily. It's just a subjective preference of the researcher. And so now we're stuck in this kind of horrible world where if you have a different social welfare function than the next person, we're not going to make any progress necessarily. You can certainly solve for the class of all social welfare functions that would make you prefer a policy. That'd be fine, but you're going to still be stuck in this world where it's difficult to really resolve these interpersonal comparisons. All right. So what do I want to talk about in this lecture? Well, I want to give you one way of thinking about how to resolve interpersonal comparisons that I like, and the way that I like to think about this problem that's rooted in a lot of different ideas in existing literature, and I'll try to highlight that as I go along. But what I want to do is revisit this Calder-Hicks idea and make one modification that I think is really crucial and highlights some of the advances that have occurred in this literature over the last 40 years, primarily beginning with Merlies. So Merlies, in this classic 71 paper, develops the way of thinking about optimal income taxation in a world where people are different. People have different productivities and the different ability to translate effort into output. And as a result of this kind of differences in abilities, we want to maybe redistribute, or we want to try to move money across the population. But in doing so, we can't do it perfectly. Why not? Well, the tool we have to move money around is not individual specific lump sum transfers. I don't have the ability to move money from one person to another person. What I do have the ability to do is modify the income tax schedule. Or based on your choices, I can give you a different endowment. And so as a result of that, I face an informational constraint where the introduction of taxation introduces this distortion in the market setting in order to redistribute, I'm going to have to change the tax structure of the tax schedule. That's going to change incentives. As a result, we want to account for the impact of those incentives on these allocations. And so what we're going to do today is talk through how one can modify this Calder-Hicks methodology that originally started and was interpreted as moving money using lump sum transfers to account for the distortionary costs of taxation using the methods that have been developed in the Merliesian literature that advanced starting with his classic paper in 71. And so just at the outset, I want to note this was actually what Hicks and Calder had in mind when they originally wrote their paper. And although it's become to be kind of interpreted as motivating an aggregate notion of surplus where we just sum up everybody's willingness to pay, the end of their paper, Hicks writes, if, as will often happen, the best methods of compensation feasible involve some loss in productive efficiency, this loss will have to be taken into account. And so that's what we're going to try to do. We're going to try to take this loss into account. And so how are we going to do it? We're going to use the envelope theorem. And so if there's one thing you take away from the talk today, if it can be at least the joy of the envelope theorem, I will be a very, very happy man. Yes. There's some element of it, yes. yeah, but we're going to talk about how markets are so inefficient. It's, all right. Okay, so what I'm going to argue is that there's a simple way of actually accounting for this, and it's just a way of thinking about this notion of the cost of moving money to a given portion of the income distribution. So you can imagine if we start off with everybody being willing to pay a different amount for a given policy, that's a tough initial world to start off with and say, oh, well, do I like that world? But if I say, okay, well, let's consider that policy, but also now combine it with a modification to the income tax schedule that helps either, you know, compensate the people that are going to lose by this policy, and then ask, accounting for the distortions that occur when we actually do that, are we still better off? That's what we're going to do, and we're going to use the envelope theorem to do it. And so what do we need to weight by? Well, I'm going to argue that we're going to want to use a weight for every person's willingness to pay that is not just one, like you would in the Calder-Hicks, the canonical Calder-Hicks, but rather the marginal cost of bringing a dollar to a given point of the income distribution. And so why is that not one? The envelope theorem. Okay, so let's imagine the following just really stylized environment. On the horizontal axis here, we've got the earnings choices of people. And on the vertical axis, we have consumption. In this simple static world, we imagine that consumption can be chosen from an after-tax income schedule, which is just y minus t of y, where t is the tax schedule. Okay. So now imagine, you know, we're in this world and we're going to say, okay, well, people that earn $50,000 are going to be harmed by this trade policy. Let's try to give them some extra money. How could we imagine doing that? Well, let's imagine taking that point of the income distribution and saying, okay, well, let's give these people a tax cut. So graphically, how does that look? We're going to take some kind of region, let's say a little epsilon band around people earning Y star or $50,000 a year, and we're going to bump out the tax schedule a little bit. All right, so let's bump it out by, say, eta dollars. And so what's this going to do? Well, the envelope theorem gives us a nice way of characterizing how much people are willing to pay for that extra eta dollars of after-tax income. They value it dollar for dollar. Everybody who is inside this region of earnings, at least for a small change in that tax schedule, they're going to value those increased dollars dollar for dollar. All right. So that tells us the benefits to those people. How much does it cost to bring resources to that point of the income distribution? Well, there's going to be a mechanical cost. Right? What's the mechanical cost? Well, I had to pay that dollar to the people that were inside this region. Right? But we also know that in response to changing the structure of the tax schedule, behavior can change. And so that also brings out a cost or a benefit, we don't know yet. But people could be moving their incomes up to that level of the income distribution. They could also be moving their incomes down to that level of the income distribution. And the extent to which people are moving to first order does not affect their utility. That's the envelope theorem, and that's what makes this a little bit tractable for actually starting to think about how costly it is on the margin to bring an extra dollar of resources to a given point of the income distribution. All right. So what's the total cost of bringing a dollar of resources to that point of the income distribution? Well, it's one plus the impact of the behavioral responses on the cost to the government of providing that extra dollar, which is all these behavioral responses of people moving up, people moving down, in principle, people jumping around, changing jobs, whatever that impact of those behavioral responses are on the government's budget can be captured in this fiscal externality term that we can just think of as taking limits as epsilon and eta get small. Okay. And so what I'm going to call this inequality deflator is just going to be the marginal cost of bringing resources to a given point of the income distribution, normalized by the cost of bringing a dollar to an average place on the income distribution. So what does this mean? It just means that if I want to bring a dollar of welfare to a given point of the income distribution, drawing it from the an average place on the income distribution, how costly is that going to be? It's going to be g of y, where g is now a function of y. It's potentially got different costs at different points of the income distribution. Maybe it's more costly to bring more money to the poor relative to the rich, or maybe it's more costly to bring money to the rich relative to the poor. We don't know yet, but that's the basic idea of what's going on here. All right? Okay, so we've got this g of y function, which to first order, a dollar of surplus or a dollar of willingness to pay to those at a given level of earnings y can be turned into g of y over n in surplus to everybody through modifications to the tax schedule. Everybody with me on how that works, right? So we just sort of have now this function that just tells us how costly is it to move welfare around across the income distribution, right? And so we have this way of thinking about how costly it is to move money around and accounting for some of these distortions by accounting for these behavioral responses, right? Okay. So what's nice about what we've done so far, I've done it us all in sort of pictures, right? But that's partly on purpose. The key assumption here was the envelope theorem, and in particular this sort of local envelope theorem, where we haven't made any assumptions about individual utility functions. We didn't need to assume utility was quadratic, quasi-linear. What we did need to do is just keep track of these fiscal externalities, the impacts of people's behavioral responses to a small change in the after-tax income schedule on the government's budget. All right, and once we account for that, that's sufficient for any underlying utility structure. All right. Now, what have we needed to assume? Well, we have assumed. We have assumed sort of a partial equilibrium structure. So, does anybody have a sense of in what sense we've assumed partial equilibrium? Does anybody want to yell at me for making a partial equilibrium assumption when you might think that there are general equilibrium effects of some of these tax policies? Anyone want to draw first blood? Come on. So what did I assume when I went back here? I said, okay, I said the welfare impact of providing a tax cut here is only benefiting people here, right? Okay, so let's, it's the start of the Republican Convention. Okay, so let's think a little bit about trickle-down economics. All right, so what's the argument of trickle-down economics? Well, if I give tax cuts to the rich, I am going to actually mechanically make the poor better off. I have assumed that away, right? I just told you the only welfare impact is on these guys, right? It would be a much more complicated model if when we bumped out the tax schedule here, we had impacts on the welfare of people down here, right? Now, we're not going to put that into the model today. You're welcome to go think about it. It's both tough from a modeling perspective and also, I mean, good luck on the empirical evidence of actually thinking about identifying these effects. But if you wanted to work on that ideology, it would be a straightforward extension. All right. Okay. So what do we have here? So we've got this kind of key assumption of this kind of partial equilibrium. So these local fiscal externalities to these small modifications in the tax schedule are really what you need to know in order to understand how costly is it to move money around the income distribution. All right. Okay. And so what's the basic idea here? So I argued without much intuition or proof that this notion of this marginal cost can be used for neutralizing distributional incidence of policies. All right. So how can this work? Well, let's imagine we've got some alternative world where different types of people are willing to pay different amounts for these for this policy. Okay. So I've just drawn an example here where the vertical axis is what I'm going to call surplus. It's just an individual's willingness to pay for that alternative environment relative to the status quo. And then on the horizontal axis, I'm plotting their earnings. And so just this, in this hypothetical example, people at the bottom of the income distribution like this policy. Their willingness to pay is above zero. People at the top of the income distribution don't like this policy. Their willingness to pay is less than zero. All right. And so this would, if you were just presented with this, you could do the old Calder-Hicks thing and just sum up the surplus and say, is it positive? If so, then we like the policy. But maybe you prefer, maybe it doesn't rise above zero here, but you like poor people more than rich people. That would be the social welfare function way of thinking about this policy. So what I want to do is something a little bit different. What I want to say is, well, let's imagine neutralizing this distributional incidence by modifying the tax schedule. So how are we literally going to do that? Given that surplus function, there's two ways we can think about doing this. And for those of you that remember your introductory micro, this is going to come back to haunt you. Equivalent variation and compensating variation, right? So an equivalent variation way of thinking about this is to modify the status quo tax schedule. So we've got this alternative environment where people are going to be at the bottom of the income distribution are going to be better off. People at the top of the income distribution are going to be worse off. So what can we do to try to make a distribution neutral comparison between these environments? The equivalent variation idea is let's make changes in the status quo world to try to replicate the distributional incidence that is offered by the alternative environment. And so what are we going to do? We're going to modify the status quo tax schedule to try to replicate the distributional incidence in the alternative environment. And we're going to ask then, by how much can everybody be made better off in the status quo environment if you modify that tax schedule in the status quo world relative to that alternative environment? Okay, and so just how would this work? Well, let's go back to that after-tax income function that we were working through before. And so now we're sitting in the status quo world. We've got this alternative policy that we want to evaluate. We know how much each individual is willing to pay for this this policy, and we want to try to resolve the interpersonal comparisons. So what are we going to do? Well, let's try to replicate the distributional incidence that's offered by this policy by just simply adding the surplus to the after-tax income that people receive. Okay, so we started off with an after-tax income schedule, and now we're just going to add in that surplus function. So what concretely, what are we going to do? Well, geez, the alternative environment made the bottom of the income distribution better off. So what are we going to try to do? We're going to try to give the bottom of the income distribution a tax credit instead of going to the alternative environment. And we're going to increase taxes on the rich instead of going to the alternative environment. And so now that's offered by this red line, right? And so what's the key logical step we need to make now? Well, to first order, everybody is indifferent between the alternative environment and this red line in the status quo world. All right? So whether or not this is a good policy to change the tax schedule can largely be summarized by asking whether this modification to the tax schedule is feasible. Right? Does it actually cost too much to do this kind of a tax adjustment? Or do we actually get a surplus that we could rebate back to everybody? Right? So if we imagine that it is budget feasible, then we could imagine going to implementing the same surplus that's offered by the alternative environment, but giving everybody a tax cut. Right? And so now we actually make everybody better off in the status quo world, in the modified status quo world, relative to the alternative environment. Conversely, maybe it's just too costly to actually go to that alternative environment or replicate that tax schedule in the alternative environment. And so when you actually go to close the government's budget constraint, you end up with a blue line that is below the red line. And now everybody is made worse off in the modified status quo world relative to the alternative environment. All right. And so what do we want to know? We want to know the difference between the red and the blue line. To first order, that difference is given by what I'm going to call inequality deflated surplus, where we use the weights that are that g of y function, that inequality deflator that I defined a couple slides ago. And so what that tells you is let's imagine we take that surplus function, we try to replicate that surplus function using changes to the tax schedule. This inequality deflated surplus is just accounting for the fact that if you're trying to take money from one point of the income distribution or give money to the one point of the income distribution, you want to account for the marginal cost that the government faces of actually doing that. Once you account for that marginal cost, you sum it all up. Now you know what's happening to the budget constraint of the government when you actually try to implement that red line. All right? Okay. And so in particular here, if this inequality deflated surplus is negative, it suggests that the modified status quo is actually going to deliver a Pareto improvement relative to the alternative environment. Right? Okay. So that's your equivalent variation approach. So we've got to, you know, close the door on the other approach, the compensating variation approach. So what's the compensating variation idea? Well, compensating variation idea says, well, let's not modify the status quo tax schedule. Let's walk our way into this alternative environment and modify the tax schedule in the alternative environment to make the winners compensate the losers. All right, so how would this work? Well, we just then ask, in that modified alternative environment, is everybody better off relative to the status quo? Right. So how would this work? Well, we can now walk our way into the alternative environment. And I'm going to draw here again this after-tax income schedule. But note that this is, in principle, a different environment with a different tax schedule that we're going to start with. Okay, and so we're going to call that y minus ta of y for alternative environment tax schedule. And so what do we want to try to do? We want to try to have the winners compensate the losers. Who were the winners? Well, the winners were the bottom of the income distribution, so we're going to increase their taxes. Who are the losers? They're the top of the income distribution. We're going to make them pay more money. All right? And so what do we end up doing now is we rotate the curve so that the top of the income distribution gets more money and the bottom is paying more taxes. All right? Here again, what's the way of making comparisons? Well, to first order, everybody is indifferent between their status quo world and this modified alternative environment. Not the original alternative environment, but this one that we modified the tax schedule with, right? And so now we can ask the question, is this feasible? If it is feasible to modify that tax schedule in the alternative environment and still have money left over, well, then we can just give everybody a tax credit. And so now we actually make everybody strictly better off. So that's a nice way of sort of saying, well, this is an alternative environment that might be preferred. Conversely, maybe we can't do that. Maybe we actually lose too much money if we try to replicate the distributional incidence that is occurring when we move to that alternative environment. And here again, the difference between those red and blue lines is going to be the normative number that we're going to think about, which I'm going to call, again, inequality deflated surplus, where there's one minor tweak here that you want to keep in mind is that the weights, the g of y function, is now defined using the tax schedule in the alternative environment. So maybe when you went to the alternative environment, you opened up free trade, now the responses to taxation might be different. Right? So in principle, those fiscal externalities could be different in the alternative environment relative to what they were in the status quo environment. And so when you do the compensating variation version of this, you would want to use the behavioral responses that you would see in the alternative environment. All right? Cool. All right. So now, if inequality deflated surplus is positive, we know that this modified alternative environment would deliver a Pareto improvement relative to the status quo. Okay. All right. So what's the difference between these equivalent variation and compensating variation approaches? So if that g of y function is similar in the status quo and the alternative environment, then these two interpretations of inequality deflated surplus are going to be first order equivalent. So those of you that, again, are remembering or having nightmares about the first year micro sequence, that the first order equivalency of compensating variation and equivalent variation holds in this environment as well, as long as that marginal cost of taxation is staying the same. All right, so what have I shown here? When surplus is this kind of function, as a function of income, this inequality deflated surplus provides a first order characterization of Pareto comparisons across alternative environments. Right? And moreover, it does provide a notion of quantification as well. It asks, by how much could everyone be made better off in units of the average person's willingness to pay. Right. And so in that sense, we actually have some notion of how much better an alternative environment is relative to a status quo, even after adjusting for these distributional incidences. Okay, so what's one of the kind of assumptions that I just totally put under the rug here? And that was on purpose, because I think it makes it difficult to really think about. But you know, I just argued that we can take an alternative environment and search for a Pareto improvement by modifying the tax schedule. Anybody see any kind of problem? Like, you know, what is Pareto? What is a Pareto comparison? Everybody has to be better off, right? All right. So anybody want to give an example of when you think that a modification to the tax schedule can't actually generate any kind of a comparison like this, or what might go wrong? Jesse's looking at it. Okay. I'm going to start cold calling. It's going to be dangerous. I'm kidding. Okay. You got it. Yeah, I did it. You can still get credit for it, though.
So if two people on the same point, the income distribution have different surpluses, you can't use the income tax.
What's an example of something that might have that, like where you've got a policy where there's two people with the same income that have a different distributional incidence? Yeah.
when you were talking about free trade earlier, so yeah. Certain people's jobs might be affected by, positively by free trade, others
yep.
negatively, but they can be in the same
way. Yeah, exactly. Exactly. Right? So it might actually be really, really difficult to just use, in some sense, the income tax is a blunt instrument, right? And so that's not necessarily a very good thing, right? So let me be a little bit concrete about this problem, because at some level I'll have some things to say about it, and another level I won't. This is kind of clearly something to really kind of get think about as a limitation of thinking about when you try to make these kind of Pareto comparisons. What are you actually saying? It's pretty rare in economics we can make an actual Pareto comparison. We often apply to some level of aggregation. So what's going on here? Well, if two people with the same income level have different surpluses, then what we've actually done is, when you construct inequality deflated surplus, is you say how much on average is each income level better off, right? And so you aren't actually searching for Pareto comparisons. You're sort of saying, okay, let's put everybody into a class conditional on their income and saying, geez, at least the poor aren't completely worse. We're adjusting for the differences between rich and poor, but we're not splitting the hairs conditional on income. Maybe I think that's okay, maybe not. But that's sort of one way of interpretation of that inequality deflated surplus. Another thing you can think about doing, which goes back to a little bit more of kind of social preference formation, and there's a literature on this as well that's out there for those of you that get that are interested in this these kind of aggregation ideas, is to do a min-max type of an approach, and that's to say, okay, well, conditional on income, what is the kind of minimum level of benefits that are accruing to each given income level, and what's the maximum that's accruing to each income level. Now, if you construct the minimum, then you can show that the modified alternative environment delivers a Pareto improvement if and only if inequality deflated minimum surplus is positive. And so that's a tougher order, right? Because now you have to deal not with the average surplus, but with the minimum, which is going to be harder to get above zero, right? And conversely, the modified status quo, you can show, would offer a Pareto improvement if inequality deflated maximum surplus is negative. And so what's the way to think about this? Well, boy, if you can get this guy positive or that one negative, you can Pareto rank these things. In general, you might be worried that zero is going to sit in between those two numbers, right? And then you're not able to simply, with the income tax, undo the distributional implications of what's going on. Okay. So what do I think is, in practice, this is probably going to be a reasonable thing to think about. So what do I want to sort of argue to you is how I think you should think about it is, well, what's the fundamental problem here is that there's too many dimensions of heterogeneity when you're considering your policy, and not enough instruments. And so let's go find some more instruments. And so we can think of doing all of the analysis we just walked through, where we just had one axis of income, but you can imagine now a multidimensional surface of characteristics of people. People have characteristics X. We can now give people in a small ball around those characteristics X a tax cut, right? And so now we can start to attack those multi-dimensions of heterogeneity. What do we need to know? We need to know the fiscal externality that arises when you take a people with a given multi-dimensional basket of characteristics and give them a tax cut. All right. And so now that's a tougher order from an empirical standpoint to actually think about getting those estimates. It requires knowing how does the construction worker's fiscal externality differ from the tailor or whoever else you want to think of is differentially affected by trade. And so you would want to think about those fiscal externalities differently. And so in principle, you can think of just expanding more and more dimensions of heterogeneity into the marginal cost of taxation. In practice, this is going to get quite difficult because it's going to increase the empirical requirements for actually implementing this formula. So what I'm going to walk you through for the rest of what I want to talk through is a case where the income tax works. And so when does the income tax actually work? Well, that's a case when there's no heterogeneity in the surplus conditional on income. Right? So there's some examples. In fact, a lot of the examples, original examples, Calder and Hicks had in mind In terms of, say, comparing income distributions across countries or within a country over time, those are comparisons about the income distribution where you imagine surplus experiments that are about modifications just to the income distribution. And so for those cases, this kind of an approach is going to actually work. But for a lot of policies that are out there in practice, you might be a little bit more concerned and might want to think about incorporating some of these additional dimensions of heterogeneity. All right. So what do we need to know? What does this thing look like? What does this g of y function look like? And so what do we need for that? Well, we need to know, how do people respond to taxes? What's the fiscal externality associated with a tax cut or a tax increase at different portions of the income distribution? And so there's a large literature, fortunately, that studies these the responses and behavioral responses to tax cuts. And I'll just say at the outset, like, this literature is in some sense all over the place in this kind of size of estimates that people have reported. But what I do want to argue is that the sign is going to be pretty well estimated. And so what do I mean by that? Well, we've got pretty good evidence that, say, expansions to the tax schedule at the bottom of the income distribution causes people to do things like enter the labor force or distort their earnings towards the revenue maximizing kink point of the EITC schedule. So if you've ever seen these kind of like on the margin, what it looks like if you increase the tax schedule, people seem to, you know, change their behavior to try to go get some more of that money. And so what does this actually mean? Well, if you take some midpoints in the literature, it looks like for every dollar you try to provide at the bottom of the income distribution, it actually costs you $1.14. Now, $1.14 is kind of a joke. I mean, I wouldn't say it's that different from $1.05 or $1.30. Numbers in those kinds of ranges would be entirely consistent with the patterns that people have been finding. But that's sort of a midpoint you can take. Okay, so that's the bottom of the income distribution. What about the top of the income distribution? There's a lot of debate about the behavioral responses to changes in the top marginal income tax rate. And that's a beautiful debate, and you should read it. It's fun. People are generally not arguing about the sign, though. For the most part, people think that increasing taxes on the rich causes people to reduce their taxable income, at least weekly. Some people would argue maybe it's zero, but I think most people would have a sense that when you tax the rich more, they do things that reduce taxable income and cause a fiscal externality on the government. And so what does that mean? Well, now think of the marginal cost of bringing an extra dollar to somebody at the top of the income distribution. If you do that through a reduction in the top marginal income tax rate, you would expect that they would increase their taxable income. As a result, the cost of you doing this is actually going to be less than a dollar. Right? You're reducing, in some sense, a distortion. And so again, if you take some midpoints in this literature, it suggests that the marginal cost of bringing a dollar to the top of the income distribution, it only costs you about 50 to 75 cents if you want to take midpoints of literature. Some people would argue it goes up to one. Some people would say it's closer to zero. Quick quiz, what happens if it's less than zero? Whose name is associated with the case in which it's less than zero? Anybody? Anybody? Arthur? No? Yes, good. Arthur Laffer, right? So why is that associated with a number less than zero? What is Laffer's idea? What's the Laffer curve? It's that if you increase, that the taxes have been increased so much that if we could just reduce taxes, we would both give people more money and increase government revenue, right? It's a beautiful theoretical idea, right? It's awesome and very influential. Okay, but that's a statement now that we can make precise in an empirical notion. What is that statement? It says that the fiscal externality from taxation is less than zero, or sorry, less than minus one, so that the total cost of providing a dollar of resources to the top of the income distribution is actually negative. Okay. Anybody see how that relates to the social welfare function approach? We'll come back to this in a couple of slides, but if somebody wants to start thinking about what happens with these negative weights, we'll come back. Okay, so what do we have here? Basically, at the bottom of the income distribution, we think it's costly to give more money to poor people. at the top of the income distribution, we think it's actually costly to take more money from the rich. So conversely, we think it's actually cheap to give them money. All right. And so if you believe that premise, what does it mean for how you should weight surplus? It means that a dollar that falls in the hands of somebody at the bottom of the income distribution is, in a sense, inherently more valuable than a dollar that falls at the top of the income distribution, right? What's the logic? Well, regardless of your social preference, a dollar that falls at the bottom of the income distribution can be taxed back to the government and distributed into more than a dollar, on average, to everybody in the population. Conversely, a dollar that falls in the hands of a rich person, if you think that taxation is costly when you tax the rich, you try to tax that dollar back, you're going to get less than a dollar when you try to then redistribute it to everybody equally. Right. And so in this notion, this modified Calder-Hicks criteria, combined with this empirical evidence on the cost of taxation, gives us guidance into how we should think about weighting surplus in a way that's not about a social welfare function, but just thinking about the inherent costs of taxation. All right. Okay. Now, excuse me. This heterogeneous weights that you would put across the population occurs despite evidence that we think that the taxable income elasticity, if anybody has written a quasi-linear utility function where you've got U of C plus like your labor supply to like 1 over eta, people actually have argued that that eta looks pretty constant across the income distribution. Now, there's reasons to think that may not be true. And so what gives if you think that that's those elasticities are constant, but we think that the fiscal externalities are different? Well, what I want to do is walk you through how these fiscal externalities relate to what you might think of in terms of elasticities, behavioral responses, the kinds of things we think we're estimating when we write a log-log regression and want to interpret the coefficient on the log of the 1 minus the tax rate. All right. Okay. So I'm going to follow a canonical optimal tax approach. Those of you that have read Emmanuel Saez's 2001 QJE paper, this should hopefully look familiar. There's some more recent papers that account for some of these participation margin responses and other things that I'm going to follow as well here. But we're going to write this fiscal externality using elasticities. And to do this, I'm not going to walk you through and bore you with all of the math that you can find in those papers, but I'm going to define a couple of these elasticities that are going to be important. The first is the average compensated elasticity for those at a given income level. Okay, I'm going to call that epsilon C of Y. Then second, I'm going to define the average income elasticity at a given point of the income distribution. Let that be, I think that's a zeta. I don't know why we always use these crazy letters, but we'll call it zeta for now. And then epsilon p, the average labor force participation rate elasticity for those at a given region of the income distribution. It says how much do people kind of enter in and out of the labor force in response to bumping out that tax schedule. Okay, so we can write, let's see if this is, So we can write the fiscal externality as the sum of behavioral responses that we might want to micro-found or kind of write into a utility function. So what do you get? Well, if we think that there's participation margin effects, then you'd want to account for the fiscal externalities that result from the participation margin. And so that's just scaling by the how many people when you change the tax schedule are on that margin of jumping into the labor force. And that's just taking the elasticity of the labor force participation, and then you want to translate that into a fiscal externality. What do we mean by a fiscal externality? We want to put that in terms of dollars that it costs the government. How much does it cost the government if you enter the labor market? Well, you're going to pay taxes now T of Y, as opposed to being out of the labor force, where you'd get T of zero. And so the difference is just T of Y minus T of zero, and that's going to affect the government's budget, the fiscal externality. We're going to scale by Y minus T of Y for a way in which you define the elasticity of participation, but that's just a scaling factor. Okay, so what's the second thing? The income effect. All right, so we had this drawing. I'm going to try to draw to try to make this a little bit clearer. So we had this bump out that we did to the tax schedule, and we just covered the case where, you know, somebody has some kind of preference that sort of looks like, maybe I can get color. We'll do red preferences here. So somebody might have a preference that's something that looks like this, right? So, you know, before they were actually just totally fine sticking out of the labor market, where here I drew a status quo world where you get all kinds of benefits if you're out of the labor force. That might have been a little bit overambitious. But what happens? Well, we bump out the tax schedule. Those guys jump all the way in. All right. Right. As soon as we bumped out the tax schedule, this utility preference, they said, okay, I'm going to jump into the labor force. Okay. So that was the first term. The second term was, well, geez, maybe there's income effects for the people that started off in this region. When I bumped out the tax schedule, people might move around because you get a little bit more money, you increase Y, you decrease Y. By how much do you move around? Well, that's proportional to that zeta of Y. It's something that we would think we could hypothetically estimate in the data. What's the cost of you moving up or down? Well, that's just the marginal tax rate, right? That's the fiscal externality component of it. All right? And so what's the last term? Well, it's a substitution effect. The substitution effect says, well, geez, there's somebody who's here, right? And when I bump out the after-tax schedule, they're going to say, oh, I'll take that. And they jump down and earn a little bit less. Conversely, there's some people over here, oops, well, close enough, that jump up, right? What matters for thinking about the substitution effect and its net impact on the fiscal externality is how many people jump up versus how many people jump down. All right, so this turns out to be one of the more kind of famous terms that has become quite popular in the optimal tax literature. It depends on the hazard rate of the income distribution. How many more people are up here that are jumping down relative to moving up here, right? And so that's this alpha of Y star term. That's going to scale this compensated elasticity. So the way that term works is the compensated elasticity, for those of you that remember, is just how curved is your utility function. So the compensated elasticity you can show is basically the second derivative, the degree of curvature in this utility function, which governs these substitution effects. Right? Multiply that by the tax rate to get the fiscal externality. And then multiply by the Pareto parameter, this alpha of y, which just tells you how many people move down versus how many people move up. All right. So that's all that those terms are really capturing. Okay. So what do we need to measure? We need to measure the shape of the income distribution. We need to measure the shape and the size of these behavioral elasticities. And we need to know the shape of the marginal tax rates. If we have those, we've got a way of getting this fiscal externality, not just kind of heuristically at the bottom and top of the income distribution, but for every level of the income distribution, right? Okay, and so this is just a generalized version of, there's some notes there for those of you that want to see some alternative derivations. Okay, so what are we going to do? We're going to calibrate these behavioral elasticities from existing literature that studied these taxable income elasticities. And I'll do a range of different elasticity assumptions to try to do some justice to the uncertainty that we think we have about those numbers. So I'm going to run with compensated elasticities, for example, ranging between 0.1 and 0.5. So there's this review article that suggests around 0.3 is kind of a nice midpoint. Some people have argued that thing's north of 1. We'll talk a little bit about what that might do for the estimates. But I think most people think it's somewhere in this range for most practical purposes. And then we're going to need to know the shape of the income distribution and marginal income tax rates. And so that for that, I'm just going to use data from the universe of income tax returns to estimate. And so what you end up with here is that one of the things that really starts to matter for thinking about the shape of the income, or the shape of this fiscal externality, is the shape of the income distribution. So you've maybe heard about this sort of thick tail of the income distribution, the idea that there's this really kind of thick upper tail and people in the top 1%, there's always this kind of just thick upper tail. All right, so that's given by the fact that there's this Pareto parameter alpha that people have estimated at about 1.5 in the top regions of the income distribution and just sort of governs the thickness. What this is showing you is that this hazard rate of the income distribution is varying a lot across the income distribution. At the bottom of the income distribution, it looks quite uniformly distributed, kind of translating into kind of log normal, and then shifting into kind of a Pareto distribution as you get into upper regions of the income distribution. And so this is going to matter now if you think about this alpha as what's in this formula here. It's going to matter for how this fiscal externality varies across the income distribution. And so even though this elasticity people think is constant, the fiscal externality is going to vary a lot because this alpha is actually varying a tremendous amount. And so if we take this put all these things together, this is what this g of y function looks like for taking that elasticity of 0.3. And so what does this tell you? Well, a few things. It's more costly to bring resources to the bottom of the income distribution than the top of the income distribution. So again, kind of consistent with those heuristics we were talking through. Looks like it costs you about an extra 15 cents or so at the bottom of the income distribution to bring a dollar of welfare to those people. Conversely, it only costs you 60 cents to bring resources to the top of the income distribution. You also get this kind of interesting reversal in the top of the income distribution, and that's consistent with this Pareto parameter that was curving around at the top of the income distribution. So if you want to actually take this literally, it would suggest that kind of implicitly we value resources more so in the hands of the top 1% than in the 98th percentile of the income distribution. I don't necessarily want to go too far with that because you can sort of think of different elasticities that give you different curves. So this is showing you 0.1 and 0.5. So you could recover monotonicity if you thought that the top taxable income elasticity was, say, increasing from 0.3 to 0.5 as you moved into the top 1%, which would be entirely consistent with the existing literature. Okay, so what do we have? We've got a function that tells us the marginal cost of moving resources across the income distribution. So I'm going to walk through some counterfactuals, but before I do that, I want to return to the kind of puzzle I asked a few minutes ago about how this relates to a social welfare function approach. So we've just worked through a different way of doing this method for having a weight of applying to each person's willingness to pay and collapsing that down to a single number that tells us something about welfare. Does that remind anybody of a social welfare function approach? Yeah. You can think of these as sort of like the Pareto weights, right? It's kind of like the social marginal utilities of income, where we're getting the weights not by your inherent social preferences, but rather we're getting them as the marginal cost of taxation. Okay. So what's the implications now for thinking about some of these policies? So let's start with a tax policy. Suppose I am going to propose to you that we should give everybody that earns between $100,000 and $150,000 an extra $10 of taxes, of after-tax income. What's the inequality deflated surplus of that policy? This one? Yeah. The hint is that it's a bit of a trick question. It's a modification to the tax schedule. So what are we going to do to ask ourselves about inequality deflated surplus here? We're going to neutralize the distributional incidence. How? We're going to undo it by modifying the tax schedule. So what's the counterfactual, what's the conceptual policy experiment we're going to think about running? Well, we just said the policy is give everybody between $100,000 and $150,000 an extra a tax cut. Now we're going to change the tax schedule to undo it. So what are we actually doing? We're not touching the tax schedule. So what's the budgetary impact? Zero. So what's inequality deflated surplus? Zero. Mechanically, this procedure is going to generate indifference to any modification of the tax schedule. Everybody see that? And so what does that mean we've just done? We have mechanically generated preferences that are indifferent to modifying the tax schedule. So what have we not done? We have not constructed an argument for more redistribution. We have not constructed an argument that says, you know, this is an added reason to give more money to the top of the income distribution or give more money to the bottom of the income distribution. Rather, we're just simply saying, given the level of redistribution we are at, what is its cost? And then we're transporting that cost to allow us to use that in other settings. To say, if you have some other policy that has some distributional incidence, say it's Medicaid, say it's food stamps, say it's a housing policy, say it's something that's like a trade policy, you know, subject to the caveats we were talking about with the Pareto logic, that's the settings where you can actually think about doing this, because then you're going to be implicitly comparing the efficiency of how those policies redistribute to the efficiency that is offered by modifications to the tax schedule. Just as Calder and Hicks had this idea of let's compare alternative environments to the efficiency of modifying the income distribution through lump sum transfers that are non-distortionary, and that just leads you to sum up individual welfare, we're just going to make those transfers, but account for the cost of of the distortionary taxation, right? All right. And so that's how you want to think about this. We're not talking about, oh, there's an added rationale for redistribution. There's just a implicit cost of redistribution that we think we already have. And so if you want to evaluate policies, you want to, using this logic, you want to actually account for those costs. Yeah?
You're assuming that it's this deconstruction. Because like think of a policy project where you increase the efficiency of this tax system.
Yep.
And so, then the statistics would change.
Right. So this depends on whether or not, A, you're doing something that's first order, or whether or not you're thinking about kind of larger changes, so there were two ways of doing this, right? So we've got equivalent variation and we've got compensating variation. In the equivalent variation world, the things that would potentially change are the marginal cost of taxation within the status quo environment. So as you start to think about replicating the alternative environment, you're modifying the tax schedule in the status quo world. And as you start to try to replicate that, then, you know, as you get beyond these kind of first order concerns, then you might think the marginal cost of taxation is changing. So all of the stuff I'm walking through here is thinking about these as sort of small first order changes where you can exploit the envelope theorem. And so then that fiscal externality is just the marginal cost of taxation. But you're right in that as you think about actually replicating a significant policy that has a significant distributional incidence, you might change in the process the cost of taxation. The second component of your question is, well, if we're thinking about modifying the tax schedule in the alternative world, we might have imagined when we went to the alternative world that we now face a different tax schedule, right? And so in that world, even if you didn't face a different tax schedule, you might have done things that change the elasticities associated with that tax schedule or the distribution of income, all of which would affect the fiscal externality. And you would want to measure those in the context of that alternative environment. And so you don't need to, so it would be nice to assume that it's structural, so you can retain the EV version locally if it's not structural, if you're actually changing the elasticities in the alternative environment. But if you are changing the elasticities in the alternative environment, you would then be in the case where the EV and CV approaches could actually give you different answers. And that would then be kind of a consequence of it not being a structural parameter. Any others? All right, so what do I want to do now? Well, we need to think, or we want to think about, you know, talking about kind of notion, you know, applying this to different kinds of settings. So there's a lot of different settings one could think about applying this to, but the ones that I want to start off with are settings where we think the surplus is homogeneous conditional on income. So why is that? Well, then I don't have to deal with these kind of annoying differences of two people with the same income level have different surplus, and that's not fun. It's the real world, but you know, at some point we're going to try to make some abstractions and try to say something that we think is worthwhile and interesting. Okay. The first one I'm going to do is motivated actually by some of the stuff that happened in Calder and Hicks' original paper, where they want to think about, you know, is one country's income distribution better than another country's income distribution? And in their original setup, it actually motivates the comparison of GDP across these two different countries. Because we'd actually, if you just have lump sum, individual specific lump sum transfers, then all you need to think about is how big is the total pie. We can then just think about redistributing it however we want. But if you think that these income distributions are actually varying and matter because it costs to, it's costly to move money around, then this stuff can kind of matter. So I'll walk through a couple of different examples that are comparing income distributions. The first is going to be within the U.S. over time. Is it a question? Oh, shoot. First is comparing income distributions over time, and then the second will be comparing income distributions across countries. So comparing income distributions over time, I think, is a somewhat salient activity in the U.S. So we know that we've had this rise in income inequality in the U.S. This is showing you the distribution of after-tax income. And while one would hope to be able to put quantiles on the same scale, I, of course, had to separate out and put the top 1% on a completely different scale with the axis on the right, because we've had a nice explosion in top 1% income growth. And so that's just showing you, I guess this is only going up to 2010, the 1% does rebound after the recession. All right, so what do we actually want to do? I want to have a sense in which, to what extent is this income distribution better or worse than this income distribution? Kind of the original motivation that Calder and Hicks had in mind of sort of constructing a notion of societal well-being. And so how can we do this? Well, we need to apply this kind of inequality deflator logic, we need a notion of surplus, right? And there's actually a whole bunch of different ways of thinking about defining a notion of surplus. I'm going to do one, and there's some motivation one can provide for doing this particular one. But what I'm going to imagine is that in some alternative year or alternative environment, instead of you getting your original quantile of the income distribution, you're actually going to get the quantile offered by the alternative distribution. So concretely, if you're at the 99th percentile of the income distribution today, I'm going to imagine, well, suppose we sent you to the 99th percentile of the income distribution back in 1980. Right. Now, I didn't have to make that particular assumption, but that allows one to construct a surplus function for every quantile of today's income distribution and then compare it to other income distributions, say going back in time. And so how can you think about conceptually the question we're going to try to answer? Well, we're going to try to understand how much growth would there be, where by growth we mean kind of a normative notion of growth, a societal willingness to pay notion of growth, if we had used the tax schedule to distribute it equally. Right? We didn't. This is after-tax income. We let it expand. We didn't use the income tax schedule to try to undo it. So now what are we going to try to do? We're going to hack away at it with the income tax schedule, but we're going to account for the fact that that's not free, right? Okay. So what are we going to do here? We're just going to take each quantile, of the difference in each quantile of the income distribution, multiply it by the inequality deflator, sum it up. Here we go. And so I'm doing this on the axis here that's sort of reversed, right? So I'm going to start with, you know, we're starting in today, and we're imagining we go back in time and give you, say, the 1980 income distribution. How much would you really prefer today's income distribution relative to the 1980 income distribution? And so this suggests that this blue line is just mean household income, which is sitting at about $17,000 increase relative to 1980 if you deflate with the CPI. So that says that in terms of mean incomes, we're about $17,000 better off today relative to 1980. The red line is showing you for an elasticity of 0.3, that specification I was walking you through, how would that series look differently? So instead of just doing an unweighted sum of all of those differences in the income distribution? What if you weighted the fact that the poor have had less income growth than the rich, right? And so that pulls the number down a little bit. Why is that? Well, it would be costly to actually make that growth equal, right? And so this is implicitly saying, if we modify the tax schedule to try to undo all the distributional incidents of all the growth we've experienced since 1980, we would actually be about $3,000 poorer, right? And so that's maybe, you know, a lot, maybe a little. Another way to think about this is to sum up all of the kind of difference. So we have aggregate notions of GDP that we construct and sort of say, how big is the size of the economic pie? One way to think about the social cost of inequality is to think about how much smaller would that total pie be if we actually had adjusted and not allowed the increase in inequality, to happen. That gives you a notion of social of the kind of social cost of inequality that looks to be about $400 per household. That should be in 400. Yeah, $400 per household. So it's a decent chunk of change, but it's pretty. I prefer sort of thinking about this. You know, you can think of what is it? It's about 15% of growth would sort of go away, is one way to think about it. So it puts at least a number on, you know, how much is this cost of inequality. What you can also do is think about, you know, median income hasn't changed at all relative to 1980. That's been flat. And so what this says is that if we actually went and redistributed that money, we could actually make a good portion of the population better off. But we haven't. All right. Another kind of comparison one can do is comparisons across countries. So we can take the income distributions of the US or other countries and do some comparison. So what I'm doing here is on the horizontal axis, plotting the gross national income per capita for each of these different countries. And then on the vertical axis, plotting the inequality deflated surplus that would be offered by the income distributions of those other countries. So what I mean by that, I say, suppose you, if you were at the 75th percentile of the US income distribution, instead of getting that income, you get the 75th percentile of the other country's income distribution. Do that for all the quantiles, weight it by this inequality deflator to tell us, geez, how much better off could everybody be made if we were to, instead of have our income distribution, we had that of another country. And what you can see here is this whole, vertical line here, this 45 degree line, all these countries, if we all had the same income distribution, all of them would fall upon the 45 degree line. Countries that have a higher income level would offer greater inequality deflated surplus. But what you can see is they all fall above it. Why is that? Because, well, geez, they don't have as much income inequality as the United States. And so if we actually try to replicate those income distributions, we actually could be, if we took the, what's my favorite one? So Austria and New Zealand, Austria and the Netherlands, if we took their income distribution, they actually have lower gross national income per capita, but we actually could Pareto dominate our own income distribution. If we took their income distribution and if you took our estimates of what we think happens when you change the tax schedule, we think we could actually make everybody richer if we had started with the Austrian and the Netherlands income distributions instead of our own. So those are the kinds of comparisons you can start to make when you have this notion of the cost of moving money around the income distribution. All right. You can also think about some policies. So what are some policies we like to think about in kind of Econ 101? We like to think about weightings of things like producer and consumer surplus. A lot of different ways people have argued for thinking about weighting producer and consumer surplus. I think the one extreme assumption people can make is that the producer surplus, say, falls just on the top 1%, right? And maybe consumer surplus falls equally across the income distribution. That's sort of a Marxian view of producers and consumers, but maybe that's actually not too far from the truth. So what would the inequality deflator tell you for thinking about integrating these kinds of merger decisions? You know, you've got, let's just make it concrete. You got like Comcast and Time Warner are looking to merge, trying to decide, should they allow this? Department of Justice is like, ah, you know, I've got my estimate of producer surplus, I've got my estimate of consumer surplus. Let's set aside the idea of whether or not those are calculated correctly and try to get at the question of how should you weight them. Well, if you think that the producer surplus has fallen at the top of the income distribution, the deflator would say, well, you should downweight that by about, what, 0.6, 0.7, relative to the consumer surplus if it falls evenly in the income distribution. And so that gives you some motivation for a very particular weighting of these different surpluses. And I think what's also interesting is that this, so what is, in practice, what do they do when they decide whether to approve mergers? They use the consumer surplus standard. They actually just measure consumer surplus and say, ah, to heck with the producers. And so this would actually say that's a Pareto and an inefficient thing to do if you think of modifying the tax schedule as an allowable thing you can do to undo the distributional incidence. But it may be Pareto efficient in the inefficient in the U.S., but there's actually other estimates of the impact of top marginal tax rates, say, in France. And there, I think there's some people that argue, there's always issues with the empirical work here and the difficulty of estimating these things, but it looks like they're actually not that far off from the top of the Laffer curve. So what does it mean if you're at the top of the Laffer curve when you're taxing your top incomes in the population? It means, yeah, you got zeros, right? You got a zero weight for that population. Yeah. Did you have another question? Is that the thing you right on top, yeah. So what does that mean? It means that you could actually motivate differential merger policies in France relative to the US because of the differential cost of taxation, right? And so this is a way of, the idea here is to integrate policy decisions, integrate these ideas into the inherent cost of redistribution, right? All right. Okay, so we just did a lot of analysis thinking about kind of budget neutral kind of policy experiments. In practice, a lot of the policies we end up dealing with when you kind of think about evaluating some kind of government expenditure policy, it's often not budget neutral, either by design of the policy or by de facto of how the policy actually works out. And so what I want to kind of leave you with here in the last 10, 15 minutes is a way of thinking about dealing with these cases. So, you know, you might be, I could imagine, I would hope many of you are interested in evaluating the desirability of different government policies. And you'll go out and you'll find data on this policy and you might even say, geez, I think I've figured out the causal effects these policies have on behavior. What I want to try to give you, say, okay, well, where should you go from there? If you want to think about how should I integrate that into the question of, is that a desirable policy to do? And so here's one way of thinking about that. Well, if you think that your policy affects a particular region of the income distribution, what you can think about measuring is the analogous sort of statistic that corresponds to what we did with the tax schedule. You want to know how much are each individual willing to pay for that policy, and then how much does it cost the government to provide it? So in some sense, each individual's willingness to pay is sort of a measure of the benefit of that policy. The cost of the government of providing it is sort of the cost, and that's inclusive of any fiscal externalities of that policy. So I'll give you an example here. Well, suppose, you know, I do a job training program, and I get a whole bunch of people to go work more. That could have really big fiscal externality impacts and reduce the cost to the government of that program. So you would want, when you think about the cost of that program, to include those kinds of benefits, and that would all go into a denominator. The numerator would be how much are those people willing to pay for that policy? How much benefit do they get from your job training program that you're studying or whatever other policy that you're studying? There's a lot of different ways people have developed to try to estimate those willingnesses to pay for the policy that you're considering. And if you have the ratio of those two numbers, I would call that a marginal value of public funds of that policy. So why do I like to call that a marginal value of public funds? Well, you've got a policy that lets a dollar flow out of the government. So the total cost per person is just one plus the fiscal externality of the policy. And the surplus is just the value that the individuals had on that policy. the ratio of these two is the marginal value of public funds. It just says for every dollar of welfare you bring to somebody with that policy, for every dollar of government spending you spend on that policy, how much welfare do you bring to those people? Right. So what do I want you to do? I want you to compare it to the efficiency of an equivalent a distributionally equivalent policy that just modified the income tax. Right. The fundamental argument that I'm trying to make is that the relevant benchmark for comparison are other feasible policies of redistribution. And so we should try to think about, whenever you think about measuring the value of a policy, let's compare it to the efficiency of the tax schedule. So how concretely can we do that? Well, you compare the marginal value of the public funds for your policy to the marginal value of public funds of a modification to the tax schedule. And what's that? That's just 1/1 plus that fiscal externality. For every dollar it costs the government to expand the tax, to give people a tax cut, how much benefit do they get? So I just inverted that inequality deflator graph, because now I want to think of it as sort of a preference line, right? So I've constructed some of these numbers and some other policies. These numbers are, I put them up there for illustration purposes. They're using point estimates. If you start to put standard errors, you're not going to actually reject anything as being different from that line. So that's why you don't put the standard errors on the graph. No, don't do that. So what are we just saying here? Well, all I'm saying here is, well, for the estimates I took from this paper studying the introduction of food stamps back in the 60s and 70s, it looks like the fiscal externalities of the food stamp introduction was actually quite large, and it was kind of costly. And so if you believe those kinds of costs of giving people money through the food stamp program are a little bit higher than what you might experience through the EITC, that suggests maybe the EITC is a better policy. Now, one other thing you might say is, well, geez, the EITC requires people to work, so it's not actually giving money to disabled people. So we had that whole discussion about multiple dimensions of heterogeneity and all those kind of problems that arise when you have multiple dimensions of heterogeneity here. So what do I want to say here? I want to say the income tax schedule is better than food stamps. What would you want to say if you didn't like that answer? You'd say, well, geez, food stamps hits a different subpopulation of people at this income level than does the EITC, right? So what can I actually tell you? I can say, okay, well, your implicit preference for whoever it turns out to hit, here's the cost that's embedded in indifference between these two policies. Now remember going back to that multiple dimensions of heterogeneity discussion. You got a third policy, you could imagine augmenting both food stamps and the tax schedule. What do we know? Well, now it looks like it's costly to get money to people that are on food stamps but not on EITC. So we know if we have another policy that can touch those people in a more efficient way, then maybe we're going to do a little bit better. We just keep adding these things into the toolkit, and the whole idea is to try to make comparisons across policies to look at the efficiency impacts of these different policies. And the key inputs for doing this is the fiscal externalities associated with these policies. Right? So that's where measuring these behavioral responses becomes important. Okay. So I'm going to stop a little bit early, mainly because the second half of the talk is going to be a little bit longer. And so we'll go ahead, I think, and take an early break, and then that'll leave what'll be nice to have enough time to go through the second. But just to sum this up, the basic thing I want you to take away here is that inequality isn't just a transfer, right? So when we talk about the social cost of inequality and why we might want to care about inequality, there's this large line of literature and economics that started with this representative agent work, that started with these motivations of individual specific lump sum transfers, and it led to conclusions that were very problematic from the perspective of worlds that want to take into account distributional incidents. And these methods were biased in some sense against finding benefits of redistributive policies. In some sense, it's pretty hard. If you had access to an individual specific lump sum transfer, that would be a great way to redistribute. And so much of the conclusions that have arisen in economics over the past 40 years have been about things like free trade, things about free flow of capital and people and all these things. Not that those are bad policies by any stretch. I don't want to say that we shouldn't have any of them. I honestly don't think that's the right view. But I think the way in which we have measured the welfare impact of those policies has been severely limited by a kind of methodology that allows for these individual specific lump sum transfers. And so that's sort of the main takeaway. And so how can we get around this? Well, I think the basic idea is to use the marginal cost of feasible redistribution, things that are taking into account the costs that are inherent in moving money across the income distribution, the fact that I don't know your latent productivity. What I see is how much you earn. that fundamental distinction that Merlise had in his 71 paper is something that we need to take seriously when we think about policy analysis. And so you can use this marginal cost of feasible redistribution plus the envelope theorem, so everything was first order here, and the Pareto principle, and then you get to drop a social welfare function, but you're still thinking about this kind of coherent way of integrating kind of redistributive benefits and costs into your welfare framework. And so that's what I'll leave it at, and then we'll start off in a little bit. So, second part of the talk is gonna try to talk a little bit about notions of redistribution, inefficiency, inequality, but kind of in a different context, thinking a little bit more about intergenerational persistence in inequality and poverty and outcomes across generations, and also thinking about kind of place-based policies. And one of the, I think, most interesting paths for work going in the future as we think about the kind of link between place and our and outcomes is to kind of integrate place-based policies and notions of place-based policies into our redistributive thinking, into our notions where we think that inequality as these kinds of redistributive costs or and perhaps social undesirabilities that we might want to try to deal with, and what is the most efficient way of doing that. I think some of the stuff that is, at least from my perspective, just held a lot of promise is A, thinking about things from an intergenerational perspective, and this idea that maybe we can do more for the kids than for the parents, and B, thinking that we actually might have more policy levers than you might have thought. And I think this idea that place matters introduces just a whole new range of potential policies, not necessarily that those are the best of policies, but at least options to explore. And so that's what I'll kind of use as a lead in here. And so just as the basic introduction, you know, part one was about redistribution isn't free. Part two is at least loosely about let's try to find the least expensive method of redistribution. And sort of one way of thinking about some of the policies we considered in the earlier session is that they were kind of ex post redistributive policies. They sort of say, you know, given the earnings that you have, we're gonna maybe give you food stamps, or maybe we're gonna give you some job training, we're gonna do some things for you if you're at different levels of the income distribution. But so much of what the government does is targeted towards children. Right, we have public schools. We have policies like healthcare policies like SCHIP, and we also have very prominent place-based policies, both on the positive side, the Harlem Children's Zone, and also historically on the negative side with FHA redlining and a range of policies that have created what some have argued is the urban ghetto and sort of. Generated persistent poverty across generations. And so there's all kinds of different kind of policies. And what I want to really turn to in this section of the talk is really thinking about the promise of these kinds of policies that at one level you can think of as affecting the capabilities that people have in the economy, and the other is sort of takes those as given and gives different different bundles of goods to different different types of people. Okay, so what are we going to take as a launch point here? Well, there's growing evidence that it just might be more efficient to promote redistribution through kind of things like intergenerational mobility or investment in children. So I'm going to spend most of the time talking about some of the work that I've been doing in this area. But before I dive into that, just to highlight some of the wonderful work that others have doing. So there's this really nice paper by Wary and co-authors that takes advantage of the kind of expansion of Medicaid that occurred in the, what is it, about 25, 30 years ago. And it has this sort of beautiful policy design that is crazy, but just the most beautiful thing you get for empirical identification, where if your birthday was December 31st, what was it, like 1983 versus January 1st, 1984, you get eight years of extra eligibility for Medicaid. Thank you. So what they show is this actually led to pretty significant differences in actually the expenditures that you see today in later life for these kids. So if you were in an area where you were able, or in a setting where you were able to get access to Medicaid, it actually looks like you're healthier today and have lower health costs to the government today and to your insurers, et cetera. And so it just suggests, I think, this idea that there's a lot of things that look a lot different if you kind of take the long run view and think about it from the perspective of kids. There's also a lot of evidence that things like teachers matter a lot for kids' outcomes later in life. And that's you know, just the classroom that you're assigned to. Do you get a better teacher or a teacher that is performing better on or causing kids to perform better on standardized tests? It looks like if you get randomly assigned to one of those teachers, you will have higher earnings later in life. Not the hugest numbers you've ever ever seen, but you aggregate up across classrooms, those teachers matter a lot. You know, good teacher, one standard deviation better teacher increases earnings by an average of something like $300,000. So it's just a kind of enormous impacts when you start to aggregate things up, when you start to think about the impacts on kids and how that compounds over their life. What I'm going to talk about today is place. So what do we mean by place, and how does this sort of fit into the literature? This is kind of this old idea, not that old, I guess, but a really classic idea that neighborhoods matter. This, I guess, received a lot more prominence in the last 20 years in the literature. And this idea that you know, different places might cost different amounts of money, and that place might be a method through which inequality is transmitted across generations. And so Stephen has, I think, the classic model of this that works through how this can play a role in generating intergenerational persistence. There's also a large literature that just documents the frankly insane variation that we see in outcomes across areas. It's just a lot of just differences. If you just see so much variation across a range of different outcomes, be it health, economic outcomes, college attendance outcomes, just all kinds of college completion, teen birth rates, infant mortality rates, these things vary by place. And so that sort of suggests that there's this kind of role of neighborhoods that potentially is a key driver of generating different outcomes that we see in adulthood. And so I'm going to talk primarily today about some work that Raj and I have been doing that focuses on place, and in particular talks about the role places have in terms of generating exposure effects on kids. This idea that the kind of longer you spend growing up in a good versus a bad neighborhood can have significant long-lasting impacts on you in adulthood. And so just to give you some background of how I'm gonna flow through this, or an outline of how I wanna flow through this. So this is part two of the lecture, but of course we're gonna have two more parts. So before we even get to that, we'll do a little bit of background. So what are we gonna talk about? We're gonna first just document, again, consistent with all of this kind of variation that people have been finding across areas, we see a lot of variation in intergenerational mobility across the US. There's just a lot of differences in the extent to which kids from poor backgrounds rise up in the income distribution in adulthood. And so then in the first part of the kind of meat of the lecture, I'm gonna argue that a non-trivial fraction of this variation reflects the causal effect of the environment on those kids. And so we'll talk about other potential stories that could have arisen, that could be driving those differences. And at the end of the day, I'm gonna work through a method to really try to isolate the impact that it has on kids, to try to understand the counterfactual of, suppose you grew up in a different neighborhood, what would be your outcomes in adulthood on average? Then in the second part of the talk, we're going to try to develop a method to estimate the causal effect of spending an additional year growing up in every county of the United States. All right. So we're going to try to have a method of giving us sort of 3,000 causal effects, actually a little bit more than that because we'll do it heterogeneously conditional and parent income as well. And then we'll use that to try to understand how much of this big map that we're going to start with of differences across areas, how much of that just reflects the fact that maybe different types of people live in different places, and how much of that reflects the idea that because you grew up there, you have a different outcome, right? And so we'll try to do that kind of a decomposition. Okay, so the data is going to come from de-identified tax return information from the 1996 to 2012 income tax returns. And the way this data is going to work, we're going to link kids to their parents based on dependent claiming in the tax form. So kids, you can get, if you have kids, you get to claim a tax credit. By doing that, you actually report the social of your kid. That provides a link between kids and parents that we can exploit within the data that allows us to reconstruct who's the kids of different parents, and then we can follow those kids later in life. We're going to focus primarily on kids born in the 1980 to 93 birth cohorts. And so this is about 50 million kids in the population. So there's going to be a range of variables that are, I know everybody's, I'm probably in the data, I'm in the data, so I'm in the 82 cohort, so we'll, I'll get a shout out at some point in here now. So a couple variables that we're going to want to keep in mind here. Parent income, we're going to do a range of different notions of parent income, but the primary specification for parent income is going to be mean pre-tax household income, which we're going to aggregate over a five-year period, the first 5 years of our data from 96 to 2000, which just gives us sort of a measure of the kind of level of affluence of the parental background for that parent. What's nice, so one thing that comes out whenever you use tax data is that not everybody files taxes. So if you don't have tax liability, you don't have to file taxes. And that's the case for a decent fraction of the population. Fortunately for us, the data also includes information returns. So things like W-2s, things like 1099s, forms that get filed to the IRS that provide information about taxable income for these populations, we can still recover their earnings even in the event that they don't file. So we get to use that as well. And so then we'll have that for parent income, and then for child income, we're going to also measure pre-tax household income, measured at various ages. So a lot of the analysis we're going to walk through, we're going to think of, you know, your earnings at 26 or your earnings at age 30, different types of outcomes that we can see in the data. And so then we'll show you a lot of the robustness to the different types of income definitions for the kids to look at kind of differences in life cycle patterns and things like that. One of the somewhat non-standard ways we're going to think about this data or use this data is that for a lot of the specifications, we're going to focus on percentile ranks in the income distribution. And so whenever I say a child's income rank or a parent's income rank, I mean the following. Within your birth cohort, we're going to imagine taking every child and ordering them from the child that earns the least to the child that earns the most, and then give you a number 0 to 100 that corresponds to where you fall in the income distribution of your cohort for whatever year we're measuring the outcome. And then we're going to do the same thing for parents of the kids in that birth cohort. So, you know, like me, I'm in the 1982 birth cohort. I would fall somewhere in the 0 to 100 for myself. My parents, I would then rank them relative to all the other parents of people born in 1982. They get a score between 0 and 100. This just turns out to be a nice transformation of the data for reasons I'll show you in a few slides. Okay, so I want to start off by talking about the geography of intergenerational mobility in the US. So to do this, we need to have a notion of geography and a notion of comparison across places. So the way we conceptualize this is that there's a lot of different ways you could think about defining a neighborhood. Probably maybe the most natural one would actually be a census block or a census tract. So you can think of you know, different levels of these aggregations as having maybe different effects. So you could imagine your commuting zone of which would be an aggregation of counties. Your county might have an effect. Your zip code maybe has an effect. Your school district maybe has an effect. Your census block maybe has an effect. What we're gonna do is do what we think is mainly driven by feasibility, and we're gonna estimate things at the commuting zone level and the county level. And so we're gonna actually be kind of aggregating up. So commuting zones are these aggregations of counties, just to give you a sense of Chicago. So this would include the western suburbs. It would include portions of northern Indiana, and it goes all the way up almost to Milwaukee, but Milwaukee would be a separate commuting zone. And these were constructed as just notions of kind of places where people live and work, using census data on commuting patterns. And so the reason we're going to be using these very large aggregations of places is that it's going to hopefully become apparent when we talk about a lot of the empirical work that we're really going to need to have a precise measure and a very well-estimated measure of the outcomes of the children who grow up in these areas. And so counties and commuting zones are places where we're actually going to be able to have enough data to really get precise measures for those statistics. Happy to talk about some work, ongoing work that we're doing, going down to finer levels of geography that requires a little bit more work methodologically. But for what I'll talk about mostly today, we're going to focus on things at the commuting zone at the county level. And the way to think about this is that if I can show you that it matters what county you grow up in, well, then I've also shown you that it probably, you know, it matters what block you're in, as long as you at least crossed counties when you moved across the block. But to a large extent, we're probably going to be dramatically underestimating the actual causal effect of a given neighborhood if you think neighborhoods matter within counties. And I'll provide some evidence that this is true from the MTO experiment that I'll show you some results for a little bit later on. All right. So, want to begin here with just a descriptive characterization of children's outcomes in each commuting zone. And as I think I might have mentioned how our methodology is going to unfold, we're going to rely on people that move across areas to, while their kids are growing up, to estimate the impact places have on kids later on. And so that's going to focus on a sample of movers, people moving across places. But I want to start off and focus on outcomes of people who don't move, the kind of complement of that set of people. And so I'm going to call these people permanent residents. And a permanent resident is just going to be kids whose parents don't move outside of that commuting zone throughout the sample window. So throughout the 1996 to 2012 window that we see in the data, there's going to be a sample of people. In fact, the majority of people are actually not going to cross that commuting zone boundary. And so I'm not going to condition on where the kids are living as adults. I'm going to condition on where the parents stay living. So this would be a case where the parents don't leave the commuting zone, but the kids, maybe they get a job and go leave. But we're going to call these people permanent residents. And so this is obviously an endogenous choice, right, of the parents, and so we can keep that in mind as we go. But one of the things that I want to do first is just to characterize the relationship between the child's income rank and the parent's income rank, call that P, for each commuting zone C, and birth cohort S. And so just to be a little bit concrete here, this is showing you a graph from a sample of every child who was born in 1985, whose parents were raised here, whose parents stayed in Chicago from 1996 to 2012. So they're a permanent resident of Chicago. And what this is plotting on the horizontal axis is the parents' rank in the national income distribution. And then for each of those parents, for each of these different ranks, we take that bin and then we say, on average, where do those kids fall in the distribution of the 26-year-olds in the national income distribution? So this is showing you the average child's income rank at age 26 as a function of parental income for kids who grew up in Chicago and were part of the 1985 cohort. All right. And so what's nice about this, and this is one of the reasons we like this rank specification, is that it's a fairly linear pattern. And this linearity seems to hold across a large set of commuting zones, in fact, pretty much all of them. And so what that lets us do is form a parametric prediction of where a child of a permanent resident would fall in the national distribution of kids as a function of where their parents are in the national income distribution, right? So we've got this sort of intercept, and then we've got a slope of this line, so we can form that prediction for any parent income level. We can form an expectation of where we would expect those kids to fall in the income distribution just by taking the slope and multiplying by the parent's income and adding in the intercept. And so what's nice is now this gets us a way of summarizing with just two numbers the expected outcomes of kids at different parental income levels for each commuting zone in the United States. And so I can now show you how this is, you know, this is just for Chicago. I can show you now how this varies across the United States by fixing a given level of parental income. Concretely, let's take below median income parents, so people at the 25th percentile of the national income distribution, and ask where do those kids fall in the distribution of income of their of the kids in their cohort. And so you end up with this map. Here, darker colors correspond to lower outcomes for kids, lighter colors correspond to higher outcomes. And I guess the first thing to note is just the wide variation again that you see in these outcomes. Remember, this is sort of holding parental income fixed, right? We've kind of fixed it. Concretely, it's about $30,000 of parental income. But we're seeing just dramatically different outcomes for kids at these different income levels. So if you're born in the South, portions of the Rust Belt, you tend to have lower outcomes if you're born to these below median income parents. If you're born in the Midwest, so I actually grew up in Minnesota, right about there. It's actually a pretty decent place for low-income kids to grow up, aside from Milwaukee and Chicago, and also aside from the Pine Ridge Native American Reservation, for those of you that are familiar with the literature on the poverty that's kind of stricken that area as well. And so you just get a wide amount of variation. You can also see that the inner cities tend to have lower rates of upward mobility. You know, you can see Kansas City, you can see St. Louis. You can start to pick out some of those places as well. And so just to put some magnitudes on these statistics, the difference in sort of dollar value incomes for a kind of red area versus a white colored area is about $10,000 of annual income. You're thinking of about $20,000 versus $30,000 of income. Yes, good questions. Keep bring the questions.
I'm just wondering if you have like a count for house of living.
Yeah.
Because,
yeah.
You know, in some of these places that are very red, they also have lower cost of living. So,
yeah. So there's actually no, yeah, so there's two answers I can give you. So the cheapest places are actually the heart of the Midwest to some of the cheapest places to live, and also the South as well. So when you adjust for cost of living, so you can do this in a range of different ways, you don't end up with a very significantly different picture. Another thing you can do is you can define all of the ranks within the commuting zone instead of at the national level, and you actually end up seeing, you see a map that's correlated at about 0.83 with the baseline, like the spatial pattern. And so you end up with a pretty similar kind of story of intergenerational mobility and how it varies across places. And I think that the logic here is it's actually, you know, not the case either that this systematically varies with housing prices or that this systematically varies with the levels of income. This does seem to, as I'll show you, it's going to vary more with things like the number of bowling alleys in the area, but we'll talk about that in a second. Yeah, it makes you rethink everything, right? And so it's not exactly a story of rich and poor, and part of that is because we've conditioned on parent income already. But you know, I think a lot of it is just there's differences in what these places do for producing outcomes for low-income kids. The other thing to note is that there's not as much difference if we were to do this, and I'm not going to dive into this because I'm going to dive into the movers stuff, but if you did this separately for kids of more affluent families, you wouldn't find as much geographic difference. So to some extent, there's more evidence of just variation across areas for low-income families than from high-income families. Not that there's not effects for high-income families by any stretch, but some of the kind of extreme differences in the extremely low outcomes you see in the South, that's not as present for high-income families. Yeah?
So for parents who have multiple children,
yeah.
So you take average amount of children, right? So that would give people ways to the parent generation, or for those who have more kids.
So if you have, so just to be clear, this is, so if you have multiple kids, so your kids would probably be in different cohorts, but we assign, in some sense, the parents with multiple kids, they would show up sort of multiple times. Those parents would show up multiple times in the data.
Okay,
right?
So still giving equal weights to the kids for the kid generation.
So each kid, so the unit of observation that you want to think about here is the child. And so the when we define the ranks, the unit is the where does the child fall in the income distribution. But the ranks, again, are more of a simplification, just a translation of the income distribution that gives us this linearity that allows us to increase statistical precision. We have replicated this using just levels of income, and you get a very similar, albeit slightly noisier, picture because you get the kind of thicker upper tail of the income distribution, which is kind of annoying if you don't take transformations. Another more common thing people have done is to take logs. Now, the problem with logs is about 10% of the population of kids at this age have zero income. And so taking log of zero or dealing with anything of low income levels, right? And so that's actually not, I mean, one of the things you see here is that, you know, that's consistent with what we know about incarceration rates for some of these populations for low income kids. You know, how do you want to treat those incomes? Our treatment of them is to assign them the mean rank of people with zero income. So because we have roughly 10% of people without income, they get a child rank of 5, right? And so that's how they end up in that picture. And so dealing with that is just a tough issue for taking logs, but the rank is a nice kind of specification that gets around some of those outliers that you would see with just mean income.
Yeah, levels. I guess I got confused because when you say the mean child income, so I thought that's the average across kids, but that's just the average across different years of one kid, right?
No, so what is the mean child rank is aggregating across all kids in Chicago whose parents are at the bottom of the income distribution. So in practice, if you looked at a scatter plot, there would be a distribution of outcomes here, of ranks that would be bounded between 0 and 1, right? But it would be a distribution. What you can also see is that the quantiles of that distribution are linear up to about the 90th and the 10th percentiles, and then, Emmanuel likes this one. If you look at the fraction of the odds that your kid's in the top 1%, that actually has a nonlinear pattern, where if you're born to the top regions of the income distribution, there's like this kind of kicker that kicks in, and you're actually quite likely to be, relatively likely to be in the top 1%. Going all the way into the back, and I'll come back again.
Yeah, so I have a question. So how should we think about this measure?
Yeah.
Because from the graph, again, I know that this is an expectation of each one that I express in chat, but it seems that it's impossible to get in the first percentile in the next generation based on the graph. So if you are in the.
No, there's a distribution of outcomes. So if your child is at the 10th, if your parents are at the 10th percentile, there's still a chance you'll be in the bottom percentile. In fact, if you aggregate across all of these, it would be a 1% chance of being in the bottom of the 1% of the kids' distribution. But what this is the conditional expectation of the child's rank. And so there is a distribution sitting around each of these. And what we're showing you is that the mean of that distribution is linear here. And then what we show you here is, again, the means of kids whose parents are at the 25th percentile of the distribution. But there is meaningful variation around the mean that's highly correlated. So some one result actually, I'll give this one to Pat Klein, who actually shows that you can pretty well approximate the full joint distribution. So like if you want all the different quantiles, by using a log normal model of virtual income, where if you add everybody, if you add to every child's income about $25,000 or so, it looks pretty log normal. And so then you can log normal as a function of parents' income. So it's like a joint not log normal model. And so then you could actually parameterize not only the mean, but also all the different quantiles using a fairly, using 9 parameters, which is pretty nice. Yeah.
So before you mentioned that grabbing the map, if we replicate the map for more affluent families, the picture is...
Yeah, the 75th percentile.
But
yeah.
For, I mean, if you look at the states where there is more upward mobility, there must be some kid of affluent family that falls in the ranks, right? Because if...
There is an adding up constraint that happens across all 700 commuting zones. So there's only 740 degrees of freedom of the 741 commuting zones. But in practice, that's just not a big effect. So remember, everything's measured in the national income distribution here, right? And there's 741 of these things that you're looking at. So you're right that if everybody's income went up by a dollar, this map would sort of look the same, right? Because it's just a rank measure. And that rank is defined in the national income distribution. And so in that sense, we're abstracting from some sort of aggregate growth. But for making comparisons across the country, the way to think about it is it's just a transformation of income. You could do this in terms of income dollars, and the map would look very similar. Does that make sense? No?
I will make that.
Okay, sure.
What do you gain from assuming?
Yeah, so we'll show you the number of parameters we would need to estimate so there's not as much, there's a lot of data for Chicago, right? There's not as much data for, I don't know, do you know the name of that? So in practice, this ends up being a way of giving us a precise measure of the conditional expectation, and while actually using more of the data, right? And that's going to be useful when we start to do some of this movers work to give us more precise estimates for some of these, especially smaller places. Yeah.
Do you have variations in the degree of linearity, like across the country? You might have the distribution starts to go off.
Right. No. So in the QJE paper one, there's an appendix thing that shows you for the 50 largest commuting zones, shows you how the income distribution varies, but the linearity is just this like. I mean, I think it's beautiful straight line that just doesn't, that seems just insanely robust. So there are other notions of income, there are other transformations of parental income that will not give you perfect linearity. Also, this is pretty robust, this deviation from linearity here. I don't know if you can see it, but this curve down towards the bottom, you actually do see a little bit of that. But in terms of forming predictions at 25 and 75 for a lot of what we're going to do, this is just a simple way to use all the data. Some of the robustness that we've done is to say, if you're worried about a lot of nonlinearity, is to just cut out, when you do the 25th percentile, cut out the top of the top half of the income distribution and correlate the estimates. And there you end up with really pretty high correlations, but it's not, it's just a way of aggregating the data because it looks like it's so linear. It's just a really useful way of using as much information as you can. And for some of the placebo tests I'm going to talk you through in about half an hour or so, it's going to be useful to have that notion of precision. As long as we don't think there's any systematic bias in introducing these parametric restrictions, which I don't think that we have any, we can talk through it, but I don't think we have any kind of too strong of concerns on that front. It just really helps us get this kind of statistical precision that we're going to want. Yeah, for that. Oh, I promised you a long time ago. I'm sorry. Yeah.
Is the parental income rate when the parent is a certain age or the child is a certain age?
When the 96 to 2000 fixed. But we'll show you a bunch of robustness with sort of other notions of the parental income rank. But for what I'm showing you here, it's a 5-year average from 96 to 2000 for all cohorts, for all years of kids' income measurement.
How do you account for the different life cycle age of first parent?
it's capturing both, right? So I think I think we're just going to think of that as a measure, not necessarily. So we don't want to think of this as necessarily the measure of parental income that's holding everything else constant necessarily. We're just going to use it as a useful control that allows us to separate rich and poor. And you're right that the ages of when their parents are having kids and is different from this region of the income distribution. And we're not going to adjust for that. But for our purposes, we're not trying to say, you know, this is the upward mobility for parents of these particular aged these kids when they had them at this age versus that age. We're going to really just be concerned about forming these predictions in a simple way that's going to allow us to sort of remove the main source of heterogeneity we think we've got, which is that there's rich and poor parents in a lot of these commuting zones. But it is something, you're right, that both of those things are floating around in the background. Yeah.
So the role of geography sounds totally endogenous to me. So for children, do they want to stay in the same rank as their parents? That's why they stay in the same region? Or they want to stay in the same rank, so that's why they move to a different region? So how do you think about it?
So we never, three things. One, we're going to let kids go wherever they want. And in fact, most of the kids that are, you know, in these different regions, they are moving. Like 20% of kids leave the commuting zone they grow up in. And this is just the permanent residents are based on where the parents live. So this is allowing the kids to move. I think we're not going to so much be focused on where the kids choose to move. What we're going to end up doing, and you're right to be concerned about a whole bunch of endogeneity concerns that we haven't even begun to discuss, where people live could be endogenous, right? And that's going to be a key concern that I haven't talked about at all because we haven't even talked about movers yet.
This is just permanent residents.
Yeah.
In the map too.
Yeah, in the map too, right? So we haven't even really gotten past any of the background, but I like the questions. Yeah.
Good question. Do you have access to data about the recent immigration status for these families?
So we are restricting to families that are current citizens as of 2013. And the reason we do that is to get ourselves a comparable sample where we think it's reasonable that we found families that where we think we should have found the parental incomes. So one of the concerns we have, as we talk about notions of opportunity here, there's often two notions of opportunity that one might be interested in. One is how well does the U.S. do for low-income kids that are growing up in the U.S. Another is, what does the United States do for immigrants that move to the U.S.? We are not even coming close to touching the second question. We are so far away from that question, it's not even going to really be able to say much about it. But it is a completely, very important kind of question to consider.
I think that could explain to some extent the geographical variation, because there are areas where there are more immigrants than others.
Right. So in the paper that focuses on these correlations, we correlate this both with the fraction foreign-born, the share immigrants, and the fraction of people that leave, and we don't find strong correlations with any of those three variables with this map systematically across areas. That's not to say that there's not some patterns. The correlations we do find that this seems to be correlated with are measures of social capital, measures of family structure. So this is correlated with a higher fraction of two-parent families, tends to have higher upward mobility, both for kids in single and two-parent households. Just it's a property of the place. Places where there's more K-12 or higher quality K-12 education systems, as measured by test scores. We also see that places that have social capital, kids, test scores, areas where there's more economic and racial segregation tend to have lower rates of upward mobility, and areas where there's more income inequality tend to have less upward mobility. Those are kind of the five things we see that are correlated. Things that we don't find are highly correlated are measures of immigration, measures of tax credits, tax expenditures, and a range of other variables on that front. Prices and cost of living, things like that. Are not as strong. Things like measures of the strength of the local labor market, fraction of people, import competition measures from China and things like that don't seem to be explaining a lot of the variation on the map. But that's a good question. But yeah. Yeah, it is correlated with growth. And so you can redraw this map after adjusting for kind of general economic growth of the area. The two places where that matters actually are kind of the places that have fracking. So North Dakota and Pennsylvania both start to look a little bit worse if you adjust for economic growth. You know, it's not clear whether you want to adjust for economic growth in some sense, right? One story is that the reason you have economic growth is that you have productive citizens from all ranks of the their parental backgrounds. But yeah. Yeah. No, that there's some truth to that story that you would see in the fact that North Dakota and parts of rural Pennsylvania seem to be kind of most affected when you kind of soak out the things that you get with income growth. Now, I guess I'll reiterate, I don't think necessarily that rural Pennsylvania is doing doing well solely because of you know, natural shocks to economic growth. An alternative story is that they have a high fraction of religious membership and a high fraction score really high on social capital measures, and that's across the whole U.S. We see a positive correlation, so they could just be manifesting that other covariate. But it is, I agree, I take the premise that part of this could be reflecting economic growth. No, I mean, Atlanta and Charlotte are off the charts in terms of their wonderful growth rates. Yeah. So that's not the case that the South is experiencing worse growth in these periods at all. All right, any others? All right, cool. So now we can do this at the county level. So just replicate everything and just sort of zoom in a little bit. So now you can start to see some interesting variations. So here we are. There's Cook County, Chicago. The beacon of hope out there in DuPage County. So I joke with this, this is actually one of the funnest we're going to come back to this a little bit later, and this relates to some nice studies. If you guys are familiar with the Gautreau Housing Project that motivated the Moving to Opportunity experiment that we're going to talk about a little bit later, Gautreau gave families through a court case that were kind of argued to be victims of segregation and segregationist type policies in the and practices of government institutions here in Chicago were given opportunities to move to the suburbs out in DuPage County, and was argued that those were having really, really big impacts on those families and those kids later in life. There wasn't a sort of, it was a natural experiment, so to speak. They didn't have a very solid control group, but the observational evidence was pretty convincing to a lot of people, although it was debated. Okay. So now we can frame what I want to talk about today, which is going to be in two parts. So the first part is, suppose you move, or you know, you're allocated, you're imagining, you know, where are you going to be born in some sense. Suppose you're born to a place that is one unit lighter in color on this map. What would that do to your outcomes? That's sort of the first question that we're going to try to address and try to think about. Well, you know, there's sort of two stories here. One is just there's different types of people living in these different places, and the other is that the places are actually having effects. The second question we're going to try to go after is to decompose this map into two components. One is the component that's driven just by different types of people living in different places, and the other is driven by the causal effect that those places are having on those kids. And we're gonna try to think about kind of redrawing, you know, two maps that decompose into those two components of the observed upward mobility that we see. Okay, so to start with sort of the first part, I'm gonna talk about the impact of exposure to better neighborhoods. And so how are we gonna, you know, make some progress on this sort of question? Is we're going to analyze these exposure effects on kids. And so to define that exposure effect, I'm going to define the exposure effect on a child at age M as the impact of spending year M of childhood in an area where the permanent residence outcomes are one percentile higher. So now we're imagining, you know, you're a person, you're going to think about, you know, where am I going to live? The exposure effect at age M is, well, suppose at age M you get sent to a place that's one unit better in terms of the color on that map. All right. Now the ideal experiment, in the same way that the Medicaid expansion that gave 8 years extra eligibility to people born on January 1st, it was ideal. Not exactly the socially ideal thing that one would want to do, would be to randomly assign people to places. Right. different, you know, say you randomly assign children to new neighborhoods D, starting at age M for the rest of childhood, and then you could regress their income in adulthood on the mean outcomes of the prior residents in the neighborhood, right? So Y bar is just a parameterization of the color on the map. The outcomes now of the people that were assigned to that neighborhood, we're just going to regress that on the outcomes of the permanent residents. We had people that were allocated to these different neighborhoods at different ages, so we do this regression separately by age, and we just define the exposure effect as the difference in the outcomes if you moved there 1 year earlier relative to the 1 year later, right? And so that's sort of the average exposure effect of moving to a kind of one unit better place, right? So we're going to think of M, we're going to try to let the data tell us what childhood is in some sense. But yeah, so we'll look at M, our data is going to allow us to go between 9 and 32. And it's going to be interesting because we actually can't go for most of our outcomes before age 9, although I can show you some stuff at the end on college attendance and teen labor outcomes that go a little bit earlier. But most of the stuff's actually going to start, yeah, at age 9. Yeah.
So you're thinking of the treatment effect here as being sort of conditional on being in the population of movers?
Yes, very good. And that's going to be important for thinking about the comparison relative to MTO, where we're going to think of movers versus non-movers. That's absolutely right. So everybody understand the comparison here. The comparison is that you get assigned to neighborhood D versus D prime in some sense at HM. Now, another comparison is suppose you know you've started in one neighborhood and you're forced to go to another neighborhood. Well, now you might have an additional kind of negative effect of I just got uprooted out of my home, and you know that could have negative effects on children. In fact, Jim Coleman is kind of a nice, we get some wonderful work on sociology from here in Chicago, argues that one of the kind of best measures of the social capital of a child when they grow up is how many times do they move when they're growing up, and this idea of instability, those of you that are like familiar with some of this sociological work and the work of Matt Desmond and his Evicted book that just came out recently has also done some work on just general family instability. So the idea that moving is necessarily, you know, potentially even a good thing, even if you're going to a better neighborhood, is a different question than if suppose you are in the sample of movers and you go to this place versus that place. What we're going to try to focus on is how much does place matter? And for that question, we want to isolate the place changing, not also the sort of disruption costs that could be associated with moving. But we'll come back to this a little bit when we try to interpret some of the MTO results. Yeah?
So you can get a different exposure effect if you define it as if this person stayed in the old place 1 year longer instead of moving to a new place and stay there for.
Good, yeah. Yeah, so in principle, they could actually generate different effects. Yeah. And so what the empirical results are going to end up suggesting is that we all look like a weighted average of where we grew up, where I can take your outcomes and regress them on the permanent resident outcomes of all the places where you grew up in your life. And those weights will A, sum to one, and B, be proportional to the amount of time of your childhood you spent in the place. And so this is kind of the underlying, I guess I'm now foreshadowing some of the empirical results, but it certainly did not have to be the case that you could decompose the outcomes of movers onto the outcomes of permanent residents, but in practice it ends up looking like you actually get both of those experiments. And actually in the paper we walk through identification strategies that exploit both sources of variation separately, because you're absolutely right, those are in principle two different sources of variation. One is variation in the origin going to the same destination, the other is variation in the destination starting from the same origin. And these have the prediction potentially that they should generate similar effects, and what we actually see in the data is that we do get very, very similar effects for those two experiments. Question in the back. Oh, good. Yeah.
Yeah. So what we're going to do is we're going to take a kid and a family unit, right, that belongs to that kid, and just move them a neighborhood over. And I presume that we're keeping the parental income constant.
Right. So yeah, you've noticed that I haven't been very clear on that counterfactual of what happens to the parental income. Yeah.
And also, what happens to I guess I want to know what you're controlling for, because you can imagine that, you know, like moving from a rural area to an industrial area might lead to a very different kind of family structure. Blah blah blah.
Yeah. So we're not going to control for in the baseline spec much of anything. We're just going to look at the move, and then I think the way we're going to argues there's a wide range of ways in which the place could be affecting kids' outcomes. So one thing places could do, you know, you move to the Midwest, maybe it promotes better parenting. I don't know. I'm just now giving my parents a shout out because I grew up in the Midwest, right? So, you know, there's a lot of different things that could be changing, some of which could be operating through parenting, operating through all kinds of different experiences that those parents would be having, or that the kids would be having. And we're going to think in that sense of a total derivative of the impact of place that could be operating through a range of mechanisms that we're not really going to, in the first pass, open up the black box. Now, for some of the endogeneity concerns that we're going to worry about, one story is that the kinds of shocks that are being experienced by households that make those moves are themselves driving the outcomes of the child and not the place. And so in that process of trying to mitigate these kinds of alternative stories that we'll come to, we're going to be interested in doing things like controlling for changes in income and trying to separate out some of what might be going on in the household to understand whether that's driving some of the shocks. And the short answer is that the variation we're going to see is not driven by differences in parental income or changes in marital status. And partly that's the income one is, I think, the one that's kind of the most important here. Certainly, parental income changes are correlated with kids' outcomes. The T-stats are like 100 in the tax data if you run those, you know, you start to include those controls. But what's important, I think, when you think about this map actually is that it's not actually correlated with mean parental income. And so in terms of the systematic bias one would worry about, you'd worry about income changes being correlated with where parents choose to go. Certainly income changes are correlated with a move, but they don't seem to be correlated with systematically going to a better versus worse place disproportionately when your kids are young versus old. And as we'll talk about, that would be the key source of bias we worry about. All right, question in the back? Yeah?
You mentioned quickly like the marital status thing. I was just curious, like if you have kids that parents get divorced,
Yeah, we follow the mother for our baseline specification and use the moves of the mother. We also have done specifications where we then restrict to subsamples where the child ends up being claimed by the families in the destination location to ensure that we're getting actual moves. It's not one-to-one, so we do an exercise in the appendix of the paper that thinks of the move of the mother as an instrument for a move of the kid and then does the inflation, and you end up with results that are almost identical, so you can actually think of this as an approximation to the IV of using the mother's move as an instrument for the child's location. Okay, cool. Okay, so ideal thing would be randomize where kids grow up. We don't have that ideal. I don't want to say that's actually the ideal, right? But it would be ideal if you were going to play with the data. What are we actually going to do? We're going to estimate exposure effects by looking at kids that actually move in the data. And so now we're going to have a whole bunch of concerns that are immediately going to fall on our heads, right? So we've got obviously this issue that neighborhood choice is endogenous, right? You wouldn't think people are just randomly moving. That would be crazy. Where would this, you know, pose some issues? Well, you might think that neighborhood is correlated with the choice of neighborhood is correlated with the kid's potential outcomes. Maybe parents who move to a good area might have latent ability or wealth, let's call it theta, all these other kinds of things that produce better child outcomes, right? And so if you went to the data and estimated this coefficient, or this coefficient here, just using the people who actually moved, you would end up with the sum of two coefficients. Classic kind of decomposition here. You get the causal effect, but you also get the selection effect, right? What's the selection effect? It's the covariance of that theta with the outcomes of permanent residence in the destination, right? All right. So now we've got these kind of two effects that we would have to worry about. We want beta M, but we have to worry about delta. So how do we make some progress? Well, I think the thing that helps us and will help us to make some progress here is this idea that we don't really need where parents go to be random, right? That's not the assumption we're actually going to require to identify an exposure effect. What we're going to need is that the timing of the move to a better versus a worse area is orthogonal to the kid's potential outcomes, right? So whether or not you go to a place when the child is 8 versus 9 versus 10, whether or not you went to a lighter colored versus a darker colored place is orthogonal to the kids' potential outcomes, right? And so that allow, you know, another way to put this is that we can allow for selection effects to not vary with the child's age at the time of the move. And in practice, this is going to be the assumption we're going to make. And so you should now, at this point, feel free to throw anything you have at me, because that is certainly a horrible assumption, right? What could be violated for that assumption, right? What would violate it? Well, maybe good parents go to good places disproportionately when their kids are young, because they're good parents, right? Okay, or maybe good things happen to parents that go to good places. And it's not the place that did anything, it's just those other good things that happened, right? Or conversely, bad parents go to bad places disproportionately when their kids are young, and you can tell the converse story. All right, so what are we gonna do? In the end, I actually think hope I'll be able to convince you that assumption one is pretty reasonable. But I'm gonna first present some just baseline estimates and then evaluate this assumption in detail. So let me just walk you through what we actually see in the data. So take the subset of families who move with a child who is exactly 13 years old, okay? What we wanna do is regress that child's outcomes in adulthood, say age 26, on the predicted outcome of permanent residence in that destination, right? So that's that Y bar we were thinking about before. And now beta M is, you know, beta 13, right? And then we're gonna conceptualizing that experiment of, you know, you start at a given place and you go to two different, you know, either a place that's lighter color versus darker color. We're gonna put in origin fixed effects that are interacted with your parent income and your birth cohort. So we're basically saying take two people, the same parental income level, starting in the same place, and imagine they go to two different places at age 13, right? What happens to their outcomes? Well, to show you this, let me partial out these fixed effects by first regressing y on these fixed effects, and then regress y bar on those fixed effects, and look at the relationship between the two residuals to give you a non-parametric representation of beta. Right? When you do this, you can see that if on average, if you move to a place that is one unit higher, on average, your kids will do 0.63 or so units better later on in life. Right? That's just observationally, that's the pattern that you see, and it looks to be pretty symmetric. So if you go to a one unit better place, your kid does about 0.6 units better. If you go to a one unit worse place, your kid does about 0.6 units worse, right? So about, you know, kind of 60% of this difference seems to be correlated with the outcomes of the movers. Now this is for age 13 moves, right? To get at these exposure effects, we want to do them separately for different ages of the kid at the time that these parents are moving to see, you know, do we see evidence that you pick up more of this effect if you move at a younger age? And so to get at this, we parameterize this slope for 13 years. We will do this for kids that move at 12, 10, et cetera, and plot all the coefficients. And so this is the pattern that you now start to see. So you, again, you start up around 0.6 and then drop down to about 0.2 or so, up at about age 23. And so this is now showing you outcomes measured at age 26, where both the movers' outcomes and the permanent resident outcomes are measured at age 26, right? So you can see that floating along. And what you can see here are a couple of things. So the first is that there's this evidence of exposure effects. So the earlier you move to a destination, the more your outcomes in adulthood look like the outcomes of the permanent residents in that destination. Conversely, getting to the flip side of experiment, if I were to show you the reverse experiment of putting in destination fixed effects and varying the origin, you would see that the earlier you leave a place, the less you look like the outcomes of the permanent residence in the origin. Right. All right, so that's consistent with exposure effects. But what else is going on here? Well, I'm gonna argue that I think we see pretty clear evidence of selection effects. So how do we kind of identify that? Well, I like this dot here. So this is the correlation of where your parents are, if your parents move to a one unit better place when the child is 27, is predictive of their income at 26. Hard to tell a causal story there. Not impossible, but hard to tell a causal story there. And so it's consistent a little bit with this idea that there's some selection effect where kids are going, not necessarily where families are going, not necessarily orthogonal to kids' potential outcomes. But what our key assumption is that we're gonna need is that this selection effect is not varying with the kid age at move. Yeah.
Just to be clear, all the red dot outcomes are for the
child's income at 26, and now we're gonna do this for different income levels, where we're gonna, instead of doing, so this suggests that basically there's exposure effects up to about age 23. And so the kind of earliest we could start to think about measuring things one might want to call outcomes would be maybe age 24. And that would allow us, because our data starts in 96, to go a little bit earlier on this side of the equation. And so now we change both the outcomes that we're measuring for the movers and also the outcomes of permanent residents and say, if you go to a place where 24-year-olds at eight are on average doing one unit better, how much better are you doing at these different ages of move? And so this is now the 24-year-old pattern that you see. And you can basically see that you get a similar pattern. Remember, the outcomes are different here. You know, the places that are producing good outcomes for 24-year-olds are correlated with places that are producing good outcomes for 26-year-olds. It's not one-to-one, and these outcomes are different, but they're correlated at above 0.95. And so you can see that you're getting this kind of, again, sloping down pattern up to about age 23 and then a flattening out. You can do this at age 28 and age 30, and again, you get a similar set of patterns. And so let me just sort of jump to the main specification that we're going to kind of run with. Is the following specification, measuring outcomes at age 24 and exploiting the most variation in the data that we can to allow us to get back to these some of these younger ages. We get a slope of about 0.038 that has an intercept of about 0.2, right? And so just to be concrete about what our identification assumption is going to be and what our causal story is going to be, our assumption is that if you extrapolate these points back, that this is delta. This is the selection effect. And that if you move 1 year earlier to these places, you'll pick up the causal effect of these places, right? So the earlier you get there, you can pick up, you know, if you move at age 10, you get roughly 50% of the difference in outcomes. If you go to a place that's one unit better at age 10, you'll pick up 50% of those gains in the difference in the color of that map, right? Conversely, if you go at age 20, you'll get about 10%. Right. So basically nothing by age 20. Yeah?
So the delta that you're talking about, it's basically determined by where you fix this break in the pattern, right? So why is it 23 instead of 21?
That's true for the total effect. For the exposure, for the 0.038, that just does require, yeah, that we have to pick, you know, at some point, but you can re-estimate the 0.038, and that's pretty stable in those earlier years. But I completely agree that, and frankly, my prior was not that, you know, if you were going to tell me that we had some kind of kink in this series, that it was going to be at 23 versus 18, I would have gone with 18, having not seen the data. I mean, the answer I guess we can give in the paper is that we do sort of the F-test thing if we're looking for where the structural break is, and it says 23. But that's not a solid answer in some sense, right? Because it's not entirely clear that that's the full notion of the effect. The other thing to share on this is that when we do age 24, we see that it's just as predictive at age 25 of where the parents are moving. Which is, again, I think a little bit suggestive that once you get above 23, it looks like it's mostly selection effects. And so that sort of suggests that, you know, because we seem to have this kind of stability both in these regions of this this graph and the stability across the ages in these points of the graph, that, you know, this is the linear collision of those two sources. But I agree that like 23 is wholeheartedly arbitrary and something we think of as more of a result than a kind of thing we wanted to impose on the specification. So I think what we're most comfortable with is saying 0.038, and that's robust to any subset of that age that we like. But if we want to then say how much of the variation in mobility across areas is reflecting the causal effect of place, we have to extrapolate and take a stand on an endpoint here. And we're also going to have to take a stand going all the way back to zero here and say, what happens? Does it go like this, or does it go like that? Or does it go like this? I don't know. We'll have to take a stand. Yeah. All right. So now you guys were nice to me, and you weren't yelling as I was sort of, you know, saying this reflects the causal effects of place, because you could actually be pretty skeptical of this, right? What are the couple of things that could be going on? Maybe good parents go to good places disproportionately when their kids are young, and so this is just different families up here relative to these guys, and so that's a concern. And so what can we do about that? Well, we can identify this effect not using cross-family variation. So what do we mean by that? We'll take two families, one that has a fifth grader and a sixth grader, another has a fourth grader and a seventh grader. If you believe this is the causal effect, then you might expect that the extent to which the difference in the sibling outcomes correlates with the outcomes of the permanent residence and the destination should be three times larger for the fourth versus seventh and fifth versus sixth. Yeah, so it should be three times larger for the fourth versus seventh grader relative to the fifth versus sixth grader. And so concretely, how can we operationalize that in this graph? We can drop in family fixed effects. And so this is dropping in the family fixed effects specification, and there's a couple of things to note. We're getting similar slopes for the ages below 23, but we've also killed a good portion of the selection component consistent with that. A lot of this sort of effects that we were seeing of these moves above 23 are just different types of families moving to good versus bad places. And so that actually kind of soaks up a lot of the concerns that I think we had going in, that just different types of families are moving to these places at different ages of their child. Note this is a result that we have between ages 9 and 23. I think some of the response that we've got from people that study where families choose to locate is that the two times you choose to where to locate, where it's really a function of your kids, is before they're born or right when they're born and right before they start school at age 5. And neither of those periods are actually, you know, entering into when we're finding the periods that would introduce bias into the results. So I don't want to by any stretch say that families aren't choosing neighborhoods in ways that are maximizing their kids, but the types of moves that are occurring between age 9 and age 23 seem to be largely orthogonal to those outcomes, at least as far as we can tell. Now, that's not the only concern. One might also be worried that maybe good things happen to families that move to good places, or conversely, bad things happen to families that move to bad places, and it's not the impact of the place that is causing the outcomes on the kids, but rather it's whatever changed, that is, whatever that impact was, that has an exposure effect on the child. Your parents get a good job, they also move to a good place, but that's what did it is the impact of the good job, not the impact of the place. Had they not moved, this would have not been an issue, right? And so one way to tease that out is that we can control for changes in income interacted with the age of the kid at the time of the move. Another story I think people have talked about is changes in marital status. Control for changes in marital status interacted with the age of the kid at the move. And just for fun, we're going to leave in the family fixed effects here. That doesn't really matter all that much. But if you squint, you could actually see how the points changed here. And so that's actually including, it does actually change the rounding on the slope. But that's it. And it's not that those controls don't matter. As I was referencing earlier, they have t-stats above 100. It's just they're not correlated with the choice of location, and that's in large part because that map isn't that correlated with income levels. Yes?
And that's because, or that might is possible because all this analysis is being done at the community zone level, right?
Oh, absolutely, yeah.
And so
absolutely.
We're not deciding between two families moving to a better school district versus a worse school district within.
Absolutely. That is a perfect point. That's also related to a lot of the spatial patterns we see are correlated with segregation. Presumably segregation isn't bad. Growing up in a segregated neighborhood is bad. So all these issues of kind of geographic aggregation are really something that's really important to keep in mind for exactly those types of reasons. And that's actually another reason we started our analysis at the commuting zone level, because we were a little bit more comfortable thinking that a priori the sorting problems wouldn't be as bad. We're actually now working on this at the zip code level, and I actually don't think for the age ranges we're dealing with, we're actually finding all that much evidence of bias at these levels. That's really preliminary stuff. I don't want to hold my hat on it, but I think that it's not that the neighborhood. I think the age thing is a little bit. I think the people that are moving to good versus bad places. another way to say it, what's the bias here? The bias is from parents doing other things besides choosing the neighborhood that are correlated with the neighborhood. One model of the world is that the neighborhood's everything. By the time your kid's out of the, you know, you can feed them, you can take care of them until they're age 5, and then, you know, Godspeed, they're gonna have friends that are gonna cause all kinds of havoc for you. If that's a perfectly reasonable, so then all you can do basically is choose their friends by choosing a neighborhood. Then maybe good parents choose good neighborhoods and bad parents choose bad neighborhoods, but that's still the causal effect of the neighborhood. And so that becomes a little bit more difficult to separate those two stories. And yeah, I guess I'm overly speculating on incredibly preliminary results, but we are working on trying to get down to those finer levels of geography because we're exactly the kinds of questions you're suggesting. Other questions? All right. So this takes care of a couple of concerns. I think actually, I think in some sense, the majority of the concerns that we were worried about going into the project. But it doesn't really rule out all of the potential stories of selection that one might worry about. So for example, the family fixed effects take out time fixed effects, by definition. But they don't rule out time varying unobservables, right? We took out some time-varying unobservables, like income and marital status, and that didn't seem to matter. But maybe it's wealth. Maybe it's things we just can't measure, right? And maybe those things are just affecting those kids in proportion to their exposure time. And so there's two approaches that we deal with to try to get at some of these additional confounding factors. The first is to rely on experimental variation. So for example, we have a follow-on paper on the moving to opportunity experiment that I'll talk through in a second. The second is actually something that we're pretty decently excited about in terms of kind of powerful methodologies to think about these kind of selection concerns. And we'll call it a new methodology, which is somewhat disingenuous because it's actually an old methodology, which often happens in the way you do things. It's very related to these over-identification tests or these Hausman tests that were actually older in the statistics literature before that. And so let me just walk you through what these are. And they're related actually to the kind of origin versus destination experiment we were talking through before. These exposure effect models, this idea that you kind of mimic the outcomes of permanent residence in a destination in a very particular way, are insanely over-identified. What do we mean by that? There's just a ton of variables that don't go into that regression that, from the modeling perspective, shouldn't, right? So for example, we look on that map at mean outcomes of kids. And as the discussion unfolded, there was also an interest in looking at what's the likelihood if you're growing up in Chicago of being in the bottom percent of the percentile of the income distribution, or maybe bottom 10th of the income distribution, or what's the chance of being in the top 10th of the income distribution based on where you grow up. Well, the exposure effect model, at least in its strictest form, would say that if I say in Chicago, take permanent residence in Chicago, and I say, what's the mean outcomes of those kids, or what's the chance of being in the tails? And then I go look at what fraction of kids are in the tails. It should be that the tails, the fraction of permanent residents in the tails, are what's predicting whether you're in the tails as a mover, not the mean outcomes, right? And then, so in that sense, if you believe that kind of strong exposure idea and kind of mimicking idea of you're mimicking these permanent residents, then other moments of the permanent outcome, permanent resident distribution, are actually not in the causal model. Therefore, you can think of them as in the selection model, right? Yeah, the potential selection model. So in particular, what can we ask? Well, let me just make this concrete. So it turns out the variance of earnings for kids of permanent residents in San Francisco is higher than for children of permanent residents actually in Boston or Chicago. Basically, there's a decent chance of striking it rich out there in San Francisco. There's also a decent chance of enjoying the weather on the sidewalk. And so that's just a higher, just happens more in San Francisco. And so the exposure effect model that we have says that whether or not your kid is either on the sidewalk or in the top 1% is going to be proportional to the exposure time that they have to growing up in San Francisco. And so in particular, the likelihood that you end up in those tails should be proportional to the exposure time and the proportional to the impact of the fraction of permanent residents that are in the tails in that destination, not the mean incomes in San Francisco. So we can actually control for the mean incomes, mean outcomes of kids in San Francisco or Chicago or Boston, and then look at the variance of those outcomes or the fraction of kids in the tails and ask what's predicting whether or not you're in the tails. And so here's what we get. So we're just going to parameterize the slope on both of these kind of coefficients here. So let me just start off with the fraction, the odds that the kid is in the top 10%. And so you get this, what I call distributional prediction. So this is on the right-hand side, that y bar is now the probability that your child is in the top 10% if you're a permanent resident in that destination. And then this is the child's rank, and the outcome on the left-hand side is an indicator that your child's in the top 10% of the income distribution. And so what you can see is that the exposure effect is 0.04. That's the slope of that line. Now, you could also predict good outcomes using the mean rank prediction. Those are highly correlated events. Places that put people in the top 1% or top 10% are also places where kids do well on average. And so that's reflected in that you can even predict whether or not your kid's in the top 10% by putting in the mean rank prediction and asking, does that make you more likely to be in the top 10%? But what the over-identification test is about is let's put them both in the regression at the same time, right? And so here you see that all of the exposure effect loads on to the distributional prediction. You actually don't touch much of that effect. Whereas on the mean rank, that now drops to zero, right? And so you can do that now for the top 10%. You can do a similar exercise for the bottom 10%. So as I was saying before, the bottom 10% is really whether or not the kid has a job. And so you just define an indicator for does the kid have a job and do the same exercise. You see again, places where kids are employed, you get the same kind of hockey stick type picture. If you put in the mean rank, places where kids do well on average are also places where kids become employed, but it's a little bit attenuated. You put them both in at the same time, and everything loads onto the distributional prediction. And so what does this mean? It means that the outcomes of outcomes of people that move across places are converging to the outcome distribution of the permanent residents in the destination in proportion to the amount of exposure time those kids have to growing up in that destination. And moreover, conditional on other properties of the distribution of the outcome of those permanent residents in the destination, like the mean outcomes, right? Yeah?
Are you thinking of the parents' place in the income distribution the nationwide level, right?
That's at the nationwide level, that's right.
Mm-hmm. So it just seems odd if they're, kind of the argument here is that they're mimicking the, ending up in the same place in the distribution as if they were, the place in the destination distribution should be what they mimic.
So your question, I like the question a lot, is why are they converging to the outcome distribution conditional on parent income and the national income distribution? The other property is to what extent is that different if you hadn't controlled for parent income, but let's assume that it is potentially different. One of the reasons for why I think it's really important for us to condition on parent income in all of this this analysis is that does help, I think, deal with some of the sorting of different income levels across neighborhoods within the commuting zone. And so I actually think we get a better notion of peers and sort of peer group distributions once we condition on parent income. But I like that question a lot to the point where I'll try to do this without parent income in the regressions and see how much it changes. Because in some sense, you're absolutely right that there's a story of you would converge to the unconditional outcome distribution to some extent, or versus the conditional outcome distribution. To be clear, everything we've done up to this point is all the conditional distribution. But there's this other question of does the unconditional distribution play a role? And how so, and you might be able to learn something about the model that's operating. I like it. Cool. Any others? Cool. All right. So that's sort of the first one of these tests. So you can do another one of these things by looking at cohorts. So another way you can predict kids' outcomes is say, suppose you have a seventh grader, you could predict your kid's outcome, not just with the seventh grade outcomes later in life, but also with, say, the eighth graders or the sixth graders. And if you think about, like, you know, where are you thinking of moving? I'm going to move to a good place. How are you going to define a good place? Well, you're not going to see the outcomes of your seventh graders cohort that's going to be realized 20 years in the future, right? So you'll have proxies, and those proxies are probably going to be correlated with the outcomes of eighth graders and sixth graders and all these other types of measures that you'd see. So if you thought that there was a selection story driving these patterns, then you might expect that when you drop in the sixth graders and the eighth graders' predictions conditional on the seventh graders, you'd actually get some signal loading onto the sixth and the eighth graders, because how did you know the particular outcomes of your kid's particular cohort? In practice, you get a similar pattern where everything loads onto your child's own cohort and the coefficients are zero on the neighboring cohorts. All right, so that's sort of the evidence that we've got on that front. We do some stuff with gender as well. You see convergence in a gender-specific way as well. So you go to places where boys do good relative to girls, your boy does better than your girl in proportion to the exposure time you have in the destination. Okay, so now I want to turn a little bit to one more piece of evidence that I think is a little bit useful, not only for dealing with selection or thinking about selection concerns, but also for thinking about policies and also finer geographies. So this moving to opportunity experiment, for those of you familiar with it, was this experiment, this RCT that was implemented in 94 to 98 with 4,600 families across five areas, including here in Chicago and also over in Boston. And these families were randomly assigned to one of three groups. So the first group was an experimental group that was given a voucher. These families were given vouchers to move to a lower poverty census tract. So if you got this experimental voucher, you had to move to a census tract that had less than 10% poverty rates. So the for those some housing vouchers, these are basically things that allow you to get a deeply subsidized rental unit where you pay basically 30% of your income regardless of what the rent is. But the kicker on the experimental group is that you had to actually go to a lower poverty census tract. The Section 8 group got conventional housing vouchers with no restrictions, so you could go anywhere. In practice, 80% of Section 8 vouchers today are used in high poverty, mid to high poverty neighborhoods. And so although people in principle have the opportunities to go to better neighborhoods, in practice they don't. And there's a lot of interesting work thinking about why that might be. All right, and then there's a control group that persists in high poverty areas, or doesn't have the opportunity here to move out of these areas. One thing to note, so even though people were given these options to take these vouchers, 48% of eligible households in the experimental voucher group complied and took up the voucher. The remaining 50% stayed in these high poverty public housing systems. And so in practice, that's actually a common statistic that you see with the housing programs. Take-up rates are very low. Take-up rates in a wide range of social programs are quite low. And there is a dearth of evidence of why. So that's what we'd say. Anybody interested in those kinds of questions, ripe for work if somebody can do some really good stuff on it. Okay. Give you a sense of what this looked like, what this policy looked like. The control group, we're in the New York setting. One of the control group locations is kind of the King Towers there in the Harlem area. And then if you got the Section 8 voucher, a lot of them would move into high poverty areas like Soundview and the South Bronx. If you got the experimental voucher, you couldn't go there because it was too high poverty. And so a lot of these people moved up into the North Bronx and into Wakefield. So just to illustrate that these moves are much smaller than the cross-commuting zone moves that we were thinking about for the rest of the paper, and it comes back to thinking about these kind of smaller geographies. Okay, so there's actually a large literature studying the impact of MTO, and up until a little bit ago, there was some negative sentiment around the impacts that MTO had on the families. So there really hasn't been a whole lot of evidence found in terms of positive economic benefits on families and teenagers at the time that they got access to these vouchers. And sort of this conflicted with some of this spatial mismatch hypotheses that have been posited in the sociology literature, the kind of where you live matters for whether or not you can get a job and all kinds of other measures. To be fair, there were impacts on the adults then in terms of their mental health. So there's some great stuff looking at cortisol levels, looking at real physical improvements in people's mental health and things that are just important beyond economic outcomes. But what we wanted to do, armed with this idea that place matters and place matters in proportion to exposure time, you might think that the people that were most benefiting from these policies were the kids that were young at the time their family got the opportunity to move out into a better neighborhood. And so that's what we did. So we went back and linked up the data to the tax data to study the kids' outcomes. And so the nice thing here is that these young kids, this was starting in the 90s, they're just now entering the labor market. So you can actually start to see whether or not there were positive impacts for these young kids. And so sure enough, we do see statistically and what we think of as economically significant effects. So this is looking at the individual earnings impacts on the kids. So in the control group, their earnings were $11,000. In the experimental voucher group, they get about a $1,600 increase in their earnings. If you scale that by the fraction of families that actually took up a voucher, it's actually about a $3,500 increase in earnings. And so it's about a 30% increase in earnings. There are families that got a voucher relative to families that didn't. The flip side of this is these families are poor. So $11,000 of income is not a whole lot of income. So we're kind of talking about having a part-time job at McDonald's to having like a full-time job at McDonald's kind of a thing. It's not exactly the kind of enormous impact in levels. But one of the things we show in the paper is that these impacts seem to be growing over the life cycle. And so if you actually start to aggregate these and sort of follow what might be plausible kind of life cycle patterns, it looks like kind of the difference between treatment control and lifetime present discounted value of lifetime earnings is upwards closer to $100,000 because you can aggregate over the whole lifetime earnings cycle. We also see impacts on college attendance. So families that, kids that had the opportunity to move to better neighborhoods are more likely to attend college, about 4 percentage points more likely. 3.5 percentage points more likely on the intention to treat for if you scale it up. No, 2.5 on the intention to treat for if you scale it up by the fraction that took up the voucher. They go to better colleges, so if they do go to college, they end up choosing colleges that tend to have higher incomes for the people that go to those colleges later in life. This was all for the young kids, so I should have been perfectly clear. This is kids who were below 13 at the time their families got this voucher. We also can replicate some of the findings in earlier work on kind of less optimistic outcomes of the teenagers at the time the families got vouchers. And so this gets back again to, so here we're seeing, if anything, some negative effects on earnings for the teenagers, and if anything, negative effects on the kids' college attendance. And so just to show you a pattern here of how these kinds of patterns look across ages, we see a significant effects at the bottom of the age distribution that kind of fall to, if anything, some negative effects at the teenager level. And so how does this vary relative to what we were showing earlier? We didn't see any negative effects, so to speak, of moving to a better neighborhood in the earlier paper. Well, what's the big difference is this is comparing movers to non-movers, right? And so this has got the kind of fixed effect of moving. And those could take a wide range of different kinds of effects. So one anecdotal story that's come out with MTO from a lot of the sociological work that people have done is this idea that teenagers, at least in this experiment, a lot of them already had friends back where they had grown up to age 13. And so when their families moved to the South Bronx, they pretty much de facto stayed and camped out with their friends, now unsupervised, in the places where they had grown up. And so one interpretation of the negative effects that we're starting to potentially see for the older kids is just a effective lack of parental supervision now induced by the move. But that's one story. We don't actually have a causal story, but a lot of people sort of ask, well, why the negative effects that we start to see there? Regardless, what this is showing is that even if there are kind of disruption effects of moves, we're seeing significant positive effects on the young families at the time of the move. Okay, so that was a lot of work to get through part one. We got through it in an hour and a half. It was good. So now we have 10 minutes for part two. I like it. I'm just going to flip faster. It's okay. So what do we want to do in part two? And so what we're going to do is try to go one step further. So what did we just do? I just argued, you know, going back to the cross-CZ analysis, just argued that if you go to a place that's one unit of a lighter color, that's going to actually, on average, cause you to have higher outcomes as an adult, right? That's sort of the basic idea of the first half of the talk. What we want to do in the second part is to say, well, geez, what did we need the permanent residence for? We used them for a lot of this kind of testing of this exposure effect model. But at a basic level, we've got this idea that exposure matters. You can estimate exposure effects without thinking of a place as parameterizing its causal effect by the outcomes of permanent residence. Rather, we think the outcomes of permanent residence reflects both the causal effect of the place and the fact that different types of people might live in different places, right? We saw that with the intercept of that hockey stick. And so what we're going to do is estimate fixed effects for each place in the US, just using the sample of movers. Throw away all the other permanent resident data and just use the sample of movers. And then we're going to use that to kind of estimate a variance model of the noise in the signal in those fixed effects. So one thing we're going to run into is that the mover sample isn't that big. We're not going to be able to draw those really pristine lines of outcomes for parents and kids for each place. We're going to get things that look a lot noisier. And so we're going to have to do a little bit of work to kind of interpret what we mean by these. So let me just walk you through what we can do here. So basic intuition is that just take the sample of movers and take the set of kids who move, say, between Manhattan and Queens. And suppose you see that the ones who moved young do better. Then we're kind of done. We just think, well, geez, then Queens looks better than Manhattan. Right? We can estimate a linear regression there, parameterize the slope, and say, well, that's how much we think Queens is better than Manhattan. And so we can just estimate this fixed effects using all the 5 million movers we have in the data and identify everything just in the difference in the timing of moves across these areas, just the coefficients basically on the age of the kid at the time of the move. And so concretely, we're just going to put in the age of the kid at the time of the move, M, and just think of TC is kind of the amount of exposure. We're going to choose 23 here and show a little bit of robustness. And if you move from O to D, you lose the origin fixed effect, but you gain the destination fixed effect for the remaining time you spend in that place, right? And we're going to control for origin and destination fixed effects to sort of say, okay, well, let's take just the set of people moving between Manhattan and Queens, and we want to isolate the impact of moving at 1 year at an age of 1 year earlier, right? Now, this is imposing that the origin and the destination fixed effects are the same, so we're actually going to get a little bit of power out of saying, is Manhattan better if you go 1 year earlier, or is Queens better if you go 1 year earlier? But consider moves in both directions and parameterize that to be the same to help us out with power. And then we're also going to allow everything to vary with parent income rank by just putting in a linear interaction with parent income rank.
Earlier versus earlier age.
Yes, earlier age at the time you move. Outcomes are always going to be used at age 26 now. Yeah. All right. And so you can estimate this whole big matrix of fixed effects. And so here's the fixed effects. The X's are just where we lose sample. But that's that looks like a large portion of the country, but nobody lives there. Not nobody, but I'm on camera too, I'm in trouble. Lower populations, right? So but for the most part, we get estimates where 90 plus percent of the population lives, but they're still quite noisy. You can kind of see a lot of just visually, this doesn't look all that precise, right? So what we're actually going to do is shrink these things, because one thing we want to do with this data is form a list of good versus bad places. And if I were to sort this data, the places that would rise to the top are almost mechanically the ones that have a whole bunch of statistical noise, right? Sort of canonical problem with estimated coefficients. And so what we really want is to form a forecast of the causal effect of a place using the information that we have what's the information we have? Well, we have the fixed effect, and we also have the permanent resident outcomes that we can see that we can use to help us form forecasts. And so we're going to walk through and kind of construct a measure of how much signal is across these different areas, and then basically adjust using a Bayesian type of a framework to adjust for the signal-to-noise ratios in each of these different CZs to come up with a forecast of what we expect that commuting zone to have on your kids' outcomes. I realize what I just said was skipping over probably about 25 pages of text. I've got 5 minutes, so I'm going to just run with that for now. But hopefully, if you're interested in this, I actually think this application is a really nice application of Bayesian methodologies when what you're looking for is a notion of forecast unbiasedness, not necessarily a notion of kind of frequentist unbiasedness of in the way we normally think about it. Because at the end of the day, I want to give you a list where when I've sorted the list, I'm not systematically lying to you at the top of the list. And that's forecast unbiased. That's if you were to do that, if you ran a regression, got a bunch of coefficients and said, I have a higher estimate in this place, odds are you just had smaller sample in that place and you're lying to me. We don't want to lie. All right. So let me just walk through what this forecast looks like. So you can derive what you want to do for the forecast estimates, and then you can construct these forecasts. So now these forecasts actually contain some bias. So we've actually kind of brought in, it's not the case that each of these different colors is the expectation of the estimate given the truth equals the truth. That is no longer true. What is true is that the expectation of the truth given the estimate is the estimate. And that is what we want. So I know that probably was a little bit of a head twister if you haven't done this kind of exercise before. But it's actually, I think it's if I had more time, I would actually spend 20 minutes on it. But so what we got here is when you look at something that is a lighter color on the map, on average, it really is a lighter color because we've done the right shrinkage. Okay. And so now this gives you this kind of estimate. We can do this in different places. So now we can zoom into New York. We do this at the county level. You can see wide variations in places like Bergen County, New Jersey, or the Bronx, or even Hudson County. Just wide variation at these fine levels of geography. I'm going to just zoom through to some orders. So here's DuPage County, place that sort of pops at the top of the biggest counties in the U.S. At the bottom of the distribution, Charlotte, that's Mecklenburg, Baltimore. And just to put some numbers on this, this difference between the 0.8 and the minus 0.7 suggests for every year of exposure to DuPage County relative to Charlotte, that your kids' incomes would be about 1.5% higher. Aggregate over, say, 20 years of exposure in childhood, you're sitting at about a 30% increase in earnings. Right? And so that's kind of the size of the variation we're starting to think about as we go across places. You can do this for that's high-income families. I think I've got, female and male. So we can do for male, we see actually this kind of really striking and sad thing that you get this really thick lower tail of really bad places, the worst of which is Baltimore. And then compare that to, again, some of these places are still pretty good. Bergen County, New Jersey, again, versus Baltimore. I mean, we're talking about differences of, almost 40% differences in earnings if you were to spend your childhood growing up in Baltimore relative to Bergen or Contra Costa or these other counties. For females, we don't see as much of this variation. Okay, so what are these characteristics? So we can decompose, what are the characteristics of good versus bad places? We can decompose the causal effect of a place, we can decompose the observed outcome. Like, I showed you that map at the start, right? And everybody, you can all say, okay, well, this is both causal and selection. What we can do is say, what is that map correlated with? And then for the two components comprising the outcomes of permanent residence, the sorting component and the causal component, how do those correlate with each of these, or drive the correlations with each of these different types of variables? So what are we showing you here? On that map, for those of you that know U.S. geography, it's correlated with race. A higher fraction of African Americans in an area tends to have lower rates of upward mobility. What we can show you is that a little bit more than half of that correlation is reflecting the causal effect of those counties that they happen to live in, not necessarily any kind of a selection effect, right? And so what is this helping to do? It just starts to kind of open up that box of, to what extent are these correlations that we're seeing reflecting the causal effects of the place versus differential selection patterns. And you can do this for the other covariates as well. I think the raw takeaway is that the types of covariates I mentioned at the beginning are all pretty highly correlated with the causal components of places. Places with more social capital or two-parent households tend to be places that produce good outcomes for kids. That's not to say if we cause people to stay married that we would produce higher outcomes. These are correlations with causal effects. But what we can say is that on average, if you were to have grown up in a place that has a higher fraction of two-parent households, it will cause you to have higher incomes. And so that's sort of the stage of the causal analysis that we're at. All right, so I'm gonna keep zooming through. So we are out of time, so why don't I conclude? So I wanna try to pull this back and try to motivate, you know, where I think things can go in the future and what might be useful for people to engage on. I think, you know, what we see as exciting is this growing body of evidence that these kind of ex-ante policies targeted towards kids can have big effects, right? And so as we think about, you know, we kind of play this game in these usual kind of redistributive policies where we think we're always facing these kind of equity efficiency trade-offs. And I think if there's one thing that has started to become a little salient is that if you really start to hit families that are disadvantaged, and especially the kids at a younger age, you can get some really, you know, positive benefits, both in terms of place, if you take some of the other experiments that Jim Heckman has in terms of schooling and other outcomes. Once you start to think about this intergenerationally, you can seem to get a little bit more of a kicker in terms of a bang for your buck in terms of thinking about these kinds of policies. And so I think, you know, I like to end a talk at Chicago by saying that Becker was right. This is always a rule, actually. So Gary Becker, you know, he's, I'm biased, so he was my undergraduate thesis advisor and was one of the, I chatted with him, not a whole lot as an undergrad, but it was one of the things, you know, he had it sort of instilled two things. I think he always had this idea that kind of human capital was important and that was something that really drove a huge set of things that we saw in the world. And I think that has just continued to prove kind of important and useful as a thing to take away. And the other thing is that he was always fearless when he went after a question and thinking about a model. He was never afraid to model anything. And I think as we start to, you know, think about expanding into these other domains, I think one of the things that is lacking in the existing work is really integrating all of this kind of wonderful empirical evidence that people have been doing across a wide range of settings into the kind of coherent welfare analysis, coherent kind of integrated theoretical analysis that I think that people have made progress within the theoretical realm but haven't really linked the two together. So if I had sort of one hope for things that you guys focus on as you go forward, one, you know, listen to Gary, never be afraid of theory. Always, you know, go back and link at what you're doing back up to the theory. But then also, you know, always try to focus on what you think is going to be the most important effect and get you the biggest return, so to speak. And so I'll leave it at that, but I'm happy to take more questions. Yeah, any question? No. Yeah.
I have a question about, because you said there is no selection problem if we vary in the age, but my question is if the parents, they are rational choice maker, mm-hmm. so they may have some observable factor like the child's ability, mm-hmm. and if they move to a neighborhood with better quality, then maybe they will have a better schooling.
Mm-hmm.
So
absolutely,
this means, yeah. So there may be some self-selection problem. So this will influence the age, mm-hmm. the age they move.
Yeah, and what would be a source of bias there is if the parents with better kids have to go to a better versus worse place disproportionately when the kid's young,
yeah.
Which could be you can get out of a selection model. I think that's absolutely right. And the argument that I wanted to give for why we don't think that's what's driving the pattern is I think, twofold. So I think that's a harder story to tell for the difference in sibling outcomes. And so, you know, one way of showing the results there, we find that the difference in the fourth versus fifth grader versus third versus seventh, third versus sixth grader is, you know, three times as large for the third versus sixth grader relative to the fifth versus sixth grader. And moreover, that the exposure effect within families seems to be the same as across families. So why do I think that's hard? So I see that the story you're telling is a selection story that is on the level of the kids' outcomes, but it's harder to tell a story now that also generates the same effect for the difference in the age gap. So in some sense, you need a selection story that is correlated with the age gap of siblings, but not correlated, conditional on the age gap, with the level of the sibling outcomes, because we actually get the same coefficient for the family fixed effects in the baseline design. Whereas if you thought that, you know, families that observe a signal of their of, say, you know, either their oldest kid or one of their kids, or the mean signal of their kids, and then they choose a place, that would partially be soaked into the family fixed effect, because the family is the unit that makes that choice.
And another question is, what is the policy implication if you just advise every per family, maybe they have another option to move to a less poverty neighborhood, mm-hmm. then this may change the neighborhood composition.
Absolutely, yeah. So I think the broad types of policies that could be interesting are ones that, you know, enable families to move to better neighborhoods, but that's in some sense, I don't know if partial equilibrium is the right word. It's not necessarily the best policy, although this suggests that that might actually deliver improvements for those kids. What happens to the remaining people is an important question that's sort of gone untouched and is, I think, one of the most difficult and important questions to estimate to understand the difference between the desirability of place-based policy versus choice-based policy. So at a high level, the distinction between these two is a debate between choice-based versus place-based policy. So choice-based policy is this idea that you should give families the ability to choose kind of where to live and help subsidize that movement. Place-based policy is this idea that you should improve places. I think where we are at is this idea that we hope that we can convince people that place matters, and so that, you know, it is a potential element of the toolkit that either improving places or helping families move, both of these could actually have effects, right? And so that does not mean that, you know, just because we see that moving has positive effects, it doesn't mean you should move people. What it means is place matters, and you either want to move people or improve places, or, you know, think of some other way of trying to get around it, but it suggests place matters. But it does not necessarily suggest that the correct policy is helping people move. In fact, if you believe that there's fixed costs of moving, maybe it's more efficient to try to impact places. The flip side is that it's really hard to estimate the impact of place-based policies and investments in place. They're kind of diffuse. The Harlem Children's Zone is sort of the canonical example where it's actually been well estimated and has really large effects and is by all accounts very expensive. And so doing the comparison of these different types of policies is really tough at this stage, but hopefully, you know, you're framing exactly the right set of trade-offs. Yeah.
You mentioned some of the different outcomes for males versus females.
Mm-hmm.
The question was, does that depend on dosage? So for, we know for sort of the teenage boys, the outcomes were not as good as those for the girls. If they move it younger, do you also still see those differences?
So in the MTO results, we really have a hard time getting at differences for the boys and girls. But for the national results that we were working through, it looks like the exposure effects in terms of the shape of that hockey stick thing are very similar for boys and girls. But the variance of effects of permanent resident outcomes are larger for boys. And so in that sense, the importance of place for outcomes of low-income males is larger than for low-income females. At the top of the income distribution, everything kind of gets reversed, actually, for affluent kids, in large part because we think place has important effects on marriage and whether or not, and conditional on marriage, whether or not the female stays in the labor force. But that's another side of it that doesn't actually show up as much in the bottom of the, as a driver of cross-place differences at the bottom of the income distribution.
So it's similar, but there's always still that gap. Is that essentially for all the possible ages?
No, the slopes are like right on top of each other, right? But what the slopes are showing you is how much of a difference are you picking up of the outcomes, say, of permanent residence or of those fixed effects that we're estimating. And what happens with males is that those kind of goalposts are wider apart. So, if you grow up as a low-income male in Baltimore, you're going to have, you know, relative to DuPage County, those outcomes are different, and those are linear in proportion to exposure time. So any amount of more time you can spend in DuPage County will just have a linearly bigger effect than more positive effect than in Baltimore. And every year you can do it, we think would improve the outcomes. And it looks like it's linear for both within the boys and within females. About 4% of 4% a year. Yeah. Others? Should I call it? Oh, come on.